Welcome back once again to Kevin Pollak's Chat Show. I am surprisingly Chat Show. And you?
I'm not surprised.
You're not surprised, Sammy?
Nah. I had a feeling you were Chat Show.
Did you know I've already hid the Offee-Comet in preparation?
No way.
Yep.
It's in the studio. I'm going to start looking already.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Unless it's one of those metaphorical Offee-Comets like you did to me last year.
No, no. It's not metaphorical.
Okay.
In fact, it's a dollar.
That's it?
To really suss
inflation
out...
Inflation has really hit Passover.
To really suss out the Jews. Welcome to episode 139, I'm told. 139, everybody.
Wow.
Please be seated. We're coming to you live on a Saturday, for those of you watching us around the globe. In other parts of the globe, maybe it's not Saturday anymore.
Wait a second. Today is Saturday?
Uh-oh. Yes.
Oh, my God. Yes. I broke the Sabbath.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I drove. I'm utilizing electricity.
You're sitting next to a woman.
So for those of you who thought that Sammy was the original Jew, or an old Jew.
I blew it.
Wrong on both accounts.
I blew it.
Man, that light looks horrible. It's just the monitor, though, right, Kenny?
Yeah.
Just the monitor.
It's going to be quite the Yom Kippur this year.
All right, I'll stop. There'll be many asking of apologies.
Welcome back. We all... went to a fantastic motion picture premiere, and by we all, I mean the folks you've already seen on camera.
Mm-hmm.
A couple days ago, through the auspices, some of us anyways, of our guest today. But what an incredibly fun and funny time this was, had by all.
No? Couldn't agree more. Great film, good people.
Right.
Good vibe.
Good time had by all.
Favorite moment of the evening, Sam?
I got to tell our guest what a beautiful penis he has.
Jamie, same?
No, my favorite moment of the evening is when Sam called me Bud Light and his girlfriend.
I did not call you Bud Light, young lady.
You said this morning you were not going to do this.
Well, I lied. No, I've had to pick a favorite moment.
I did not call you that. I was referring to the footwear.
I was wearing Prada shoes.
Not in terms of quality, in terms of comfort. Comfort and ease.
Is that what you meant?
Yes!
Bud Light comfort.
It's easy. It's not a complicated drink. Guinness is a developed taste.
It's a meal.
Yeah.
And a developed taste.
It's an acquired thing.
Let it go.
Try wearing Schlitz on your feet.
Right? That's all I meant. No slight against you.
Jamie, favorite moment.
Because it was funny.
Favorite moment of the night.
When Richard Kahn revealed to us that he has a roommate.
Yeah. I had to move out to California to continue shooting this HBO series that I'm on Luck.
Is the roommate one of the horses from Luck?
So I got a roommate. She's a woman.
Is she?
He said. And we both immediately started, I'm not kidding. Uh-huh. So then later in the evening, I say to Richard, I can't wait to hear more about the female roommate. Me too. My favorite moment of the night was when I realized that Sammy and I were only at the party after the premiere to book guests for this show.
Yep.
That was my favorite
100%.
Moment when that revelation hit me. Oh my, I'm not enjoying this at all.
Well,
I'm just booking guests.
I love how whenever we're trying to book guests, you two are just standing there like you're going to memorize people's emails, and I'm actually being a good producer and putting them in phones.
That's right.
You guys are like, I'll just remember it. You may be him. Forget it.
Dr. Memory, not my name. So, yeah, that was a lot of fun. We'll tell you more about the film as we share stories from the making of it, as well as, well, some inside skinny you may not even get from the DVD commentary from our guest today. But I do love that Sam and I were booking guests. I even booked a new player for my weekly poker game.
Wow.
Ethan Sandler, who, of course, is married to the wonderful Catherine Hahn, who's in the film as well, was talking about the Hank Azaria Poker Tournament, and I said, well, you know, I host a weekly game, and I'm hoping to take some of his writing money. He's also a television writer now.
And that's when Joe came into our lives, at that poker game, at the charity event.
Oh, my goodness.
That's right.
Because you and Beth were bored to tears.
Exactly.
I mean, having a great time.
Yeah.
Not playing in the poker tournament, and
we bonded over the fact that we didn't look like Real Housewives of Beverly Hills,
like all the
other wives there. So,
and I think the Asian horse was the other.
Yes.
Real Housewives and Asian horse.
How many people do you want to insult with the segment? Out of curiosity.
think what I said was that bad. Asian horse.
Oh, no, I don't think you've insulted anyone yet. For future. Before the segment ends, would you like to insult anyone?
Yes.
Because now's the time.
So you're saying I've attacked the Jews?
No.
Nope. All right. Sammy, anything else you want to add?
I had an audition today.
Again?
A Saturday audition.
Again with the new agent kicking
yeah,
ass.
Yeah, they are really very impressive.
As we're attempting to insult ethnic groups.
Let me take the lead on this.
Groups.
I don't think I'm insulting the ethnic group I'm about to mention. I think more or less it's the casting director. I guess. I don't know. I went in on an audition today for a young professional, and I showed up, and there were 12 Indian-American actors and me reading for this part. And I thought...
As opposed to American Indians.
Very different.
Yes.
Very different.
Indian-American.
Indian-Americans.
Okay.
And I thought, I kind of feel like a pair of brown shoes on the bottom of a nice tuxedo right now. That's the feeling I'm getting.
Goebbels.
Yeah. If you will. So I don't think I'm going to get that part. I think they're probably looking for an Indian-American actor. That's just a hunch.
They said throw in a Jew at the last second.
Give us a Jew, just in case.
So we know what we don't want.
Right.
They want a choice.
We want to be able to show the producers the wrong way to go on this, so they see it our way.
Not just a Jew.
Right.
Pasty.
Pasty, pale, short Jew.
What was the last year you had a tan on your face?
Likely in the 80s. we're likely looking at 88, 89.
Sammy, let me ask you this.
Yes, friend.
Are you aware that we're on the Hulu.com now?
Get out of town.
We have our own page.
So I'm not a filthy liar when I say that to people.
No, you're not.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, if you go to the Hulu.com,
yeah.
You write Kevin-Pollock-chat-show.
That seems like an awful lot of work.
It really is.
Yeah.
But just type in Kevin Pollock and it'll all come up for you.
That's great.
In fact, then type in Kevin, if I could be so bold.
Wow.
And then you'll get the Costner films.
Sure.
Followed by Kevin Smith's work.
Maybe a little Kevin Bacon in there.
A little Bacon, a little Spacey. 17 names down, just past Kevin Teague.
Yep.
Is our show.
Fantastic.
Yeah, very excited.
That's great.
And we could use your support. I'm not going to kid you. Tell all your friends that we're on the Hulu so we can, they test the ratings thing there too. And so we like the feedback. Speaking of feedback, we've asked you many times, of course, to tell us what your thoughts are. If you have any questions for myself or any of the staff here, write to us in this segment called Ask Kevin.
Ask Kevin.
Wow. That's the first time that's worked in like a year.
We had a production meeting earlier. We lit a little fire. And then we got the cue on time. And by the way, not ass, Kevin. That was previous questions. Is that theme song, little theme cue, music cue, singing ass?
Yeah,
Kevin, there's a K in there.
Jury's still out on that.
There's a K in there.
Different graphic altogether.
So. Sure it is. You want to write to us at contact at kevinpollockschatshow.com. If you'd like to ask us anything at all, we'll be happy to answer if, in fact, we deem your question readable. This one is. It comes to us from Rob Matthew. Who writes, listening to Chiklis interview, what type of pen did Tom Cruise give you? Must get one. You're referring to this little number. I must have told the story during the Michael Chiklis interview of how I acquired not one but two of these from the Tom Cruise while working on The A Few Good Men. That's all the dropping I will do for now. I will tell you where you can get this pen. From my cold, dead hand.
Yeah, I plan to.
Well, I'm not going to tell him where to get it.
No. That store doesn't even exist anymore.
And it's not special. Barney's
this is from 21 years ago. Are you kidding?
Well, the store was Barney's of New York. They certainly don't sell this pen there anymore. It's made in France, although it looks like a giant Mont Blanc. It is, I'm trying to get some sort of ratio here, tell you how it's crazy. I'm not going to tell you where to get it because then it's less special for me.
Absolutely.
That's where you get it.
Yeah. eBay.
No.
Just type in Tom Cruise pen.
Yeah.
On eBay.
Well, honestly,
I have seven up there.
This
listed.
Pen's almost like 20 years old. Like it's I highly doubt that you're going to be able to find
this
it.
This fall it will be exactly 20 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah. We started shooting in October 20 years ago.
There you go.
They might not even make it anymore.
What's it like to be old? All right.
Wah, wah.
Thank you, Rob Matthew, for that question, and I'm sorry that the answer is so annoying for you. I find it humorous. The next question we'd like you to write to us at contact at kevinpollockshatra.com would be, how do you do KPCS? That is to say, do you listen on the iPod? Do you have it dialed up on your Hulu? Are you throwing it from your TiVo onto your television? How you doing it?
Do you listen in the car like me?
You're driving coast to coast in your car, like Sammy does once a year. This one is from David Katsibi.
That's not a name.
That can't possibly be it. Katsibi? Katsibi. David Katsibi. K-O-T-S-I-B-I-E.
Davy K.
Davy K. As he's known to all of his friends who just got tired of saying Katsibi. Dear Kevin and team, this is only the second fan letter I have ever written. The first time was in 1999 when I sent an email to the producers of Freaks and Geeks immediately after the first show. This was fine until it looked like NBC was going to cancel the show, and Feig and Apatow sent out an email urging its fans to help save the program. Hmm. This would have been okay, except that they had all the email addresses in the 2 field and not the BCC field.
Uh-oh.
Again, this was 1999. This conveniently allowed the reply all option to now begin. What followed was 10,000 people sending out notes asking to be taken off this damn email list. Mm-hmm. One after another, they kept on saying how annoying this was, conveniently overlooking the fact that they were indeed sending those exact comments to 10,000 people as well. This went on for a while. This went on for a while with, of course, the occasional note from some guy commenting that Linda
Cardellini
was hot and he wanted to fuck her.
Well.
So at the risk of that, I wanted to say what a big fan I am of your show. I specifically wanted to point out that I think, what I think really makes it work, though, is that the way that I addressed in this note, it is the combination of the chemistry of you, Little Wolverine, and my pop culture twin, Jamie.
Oh.
I am not so cool as the people who have been there from show number 1, but I will say I started around show number 20, and I've been hooked ever since.
Wow.
I recommend this show to everyone I know. I listen to you on the bus, on my iPad, to and from work, with other lifeless drones from Sector 7G. And it brightens that commute more than you will ever know. For that, I am eternally grateful. Every show becomes a new favorite, but I have to say the Dana Gould wrap-up with his what seemed like a 5-minute Larry King game had me with tears in my eyes. Keep up the great work. Don't stop what you do. A big thank you to you, Sam and Jamie, for what you bring to KPCS. And as usual, Linda Cardellini, go fuck yourself.
Oh, all right. Well, you know, normally I would scream for having you reading a letter that long, but since it was glowing and about me in large portion, I
was the pop culture twin.
I can't say anything.
And he said Sector 7G.
Yeah.
But may I just also add, Davy K, keep sending those emails to NBC.
Yes.
Because I am really counting on them bringing Freaks and Geeks back. I got a lot of bills to pay, is all I'm saying. So all the help we can get. Thanks, buddy.
Yeah, yeah. Nice shout out.
Yeah.
13 years for your show.
I believe that is correct.
You sang 1999.
I believe that is correct.
He went screaming.
Yep.
Kenny, can you ask the fine folks in the outer studio there, the fine producers working out there who can't hear me, to crank up the damn air conditioning because the Jew's already sweating. Was there a Larry King game? I think we picked a Larry King game this week. Flip through, you son of a bitch. Oh, yeah, it's coming. We ask you also if you'd like to win a t-shirt, a Kevin Pollock's Chat Show t-shirt, to either shoot video of yourself doing the Larry King game, load it up to the Chat Show site, kevinpollockschatshow.com, or just go ahead and write one and send an email to contact Kevin Pollock's Chat Show. And if I read it on the air, which I'm about to do, this one from Caroline, or Carolyn, from Gainesville, Florida. Carolyn from Gainesville, Florida. If I read yours, we'll send you a t-shirt. This one's going to Carolyn. I like this one because it's short and ever so sweet. Mm. Too many wives, two new hips. Wee-wah, Hitchka, Florida, pick up. Too many wives, two new hips. Come on.
That's
Larry's
good.
Getting it done.
I believe Larry's on his fourth or fifth set of hips at this point, though.
Wee-wah, Hitchka. I have to ask our guest if he ever went through the Wee-wah, Hitchka.
All those wives. He's going through those hips.
Because he's from there in the Florida area. He was raised there anyways. I'm supposed to plug the merch page on the KevinPollockShatShow.com trip on by. If you go to the homepage, you'll see some doors on either side. Open them up. Check it out. I just rewrote the about the show. If you look at the guy with the camera in the front. Who's that old timey guy with the camera? Oh, looks like Visit Kevin's fan photos. Let's click on that old timey. Put your cursor on his face, and then this pops up.
What the?
Look at this. An old carny photographer, little Italian
what?
Dude, right? And then you click on the Salt Lake City, which is the last stand-up gig I did, and everyone I took photos with after the show, your photos are now loaded to the fan photo site.
Wow.
Which you may click on and then tag on your Facebook page or tweet them. There's one now.
It seems like this is the kind of thing that you see at on a theme park ride.
Right.
Where now you'll charge them $25 mm-hmm. for a really crappy, tiny print of that.
Wait, are you saying that photo's crappy?
No. The quality. Not the
print.
Picture.
Gotcha. Print.
The quality
photo. Print.
In this case, they're free.
Get out of here.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
What?
Thank
go
you.
Go to that page now.
Thank you.
Now.
Everyone who was at the Salt Lake City
everyone
show.
Ever. Go yeah. to that page now. Look at those photos. They're free.
I will, of course, be taking more photos with the fans in New York City.
Whoa.
Next weekend at the Carolines on Broadway, where I'll be doing some shows. And I can't say it's in cement, but there's a rumor that there'll be a live on stage, stripped down version, audio only of the chat show at Caroline's Sunday night.
Oh, I see.
Guest to be announced on my Twitter, which I never, do you guys ever put that up? The at Kevin Pollock on the Twitter? We just assume everybody knows or who gives a shit. as you know, if you watch the show with any regularity, another 17 minutes and I'll introduce our guest. Yeah, so check out Caroline's. If you're in the New York area, go to Caroline's on Broadway. The last thing I wanted to mention was this fabulous book, Lost in Las Vegas. These things still exist, these weird things with pages. I believe they're still called books, and there are still a few places that sell them. Lost in Las Vegas, hilarious. If you remember the Scorsese film After Hours, kind of like that, set in the underbelly of Las Vegas. Avery Cardoza, the author, highly recommend. Not starting a book club, just saying. Read it. And I'd like to hear back from you. Write, and please let me know. All right, that is all I want to say at this point. From time to time on the show, we have a guest on that is in the category that I call scene stealers. And these are the people who catch my eye as a film goer. They, like myself, are not the ones who are selling tickets in the theaters. We're not the name above the title peeps. It happens on occasion, but for the big studio comedies, which we're going to talk about today, you know, for example, in The Wanderlust, new film opening up, I believe, next Friday, you've got Paul Rudd and Jennifer Aniston. Or as your mom calls her, Jennifer...
Aniston. Still can't say it right.
Won't. Won't say it right.
Isn't that an old painkiller?
Aniston?
Aniston?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think
right.
It was.
Yes. Yeah. Not to be confused with David Janssen. Also, a hell of a painkiller. So we steam sealers, so I've always collected them because they always inspired me when I was a youngster. And I never stopped. And I started noticing today's guest in movies well over a decade ago. And then I started finding out more about him from Jamie and J-Mac, who were saying, oh, you missed the state. You're old. he was part of an amazing improv group who became this great sketch group and had a show on MTV called The State, which I believe in 1993 might have been all over the MTV. We'll talk about
that.
That's
right.
And a whole bunch of film, incredible work that he's done. And it took me 6 weeks studying, rehearsing, practicing to now mispronounce his name. And I can relate to this as well, as my own name, Pollock, has been mispronounced more times. But I want to ask him how much fun it's been for him, he being Joe Lo Truglio.
So close.
Hello.
So close.
Hi, everyone.
Welcome, sir.
Thank you for having me.
Did
here,
I skate
truly.
Around it? Was I on it? Was
you
I close?
You were on it. You know, you were right on it.
Okay,
because
good.
For the longest time, my name was, and still is, Joe Lo Truglio, but I found out when I was around 20, 21, from my grandfather that the correct pronunciation was Lo Truglio. And so I started to use that, but then I had a whole group of friends and people.
They were like, hey, Lo Truglio, what's the matter with you?
Yeah, come on, it's Lo Truglio. And they had a point because, you know, I kind of changed horse midstream a little bit.
A little bit.
You know, and I can't blame them for, kind of, you know, busting my balls a little bit about it.
Right.
So I go by either. You know, you can call me DiMaggio if you'd like, but I don't think...
You're going to answer.
I don't think I could answer.
No, not in the way that he did.
No.
It's the L-O. It's the L-O dropped right in the middle with its own capital letter representing a third name.
It's created such chaos, truly, in traveling, in booking tickets, the space that's between the O and the T. And in fact, I made it such a point to spell it that way that in my high school yearbook, it said, my quote, everyone's like, I'm going to change the world, whatever their quote was.
Right.
My quote was, it's L-O space capital T. That was how important it was that they got the name right. Cut to years later, I'm explaining to Southwest that, you know, well, it's because they spelled it wrong on my license.
Here's what you should have said to Southwest. Give me an assigned seat, fucko, and I'll tell you how to pronounce
it. And I'll give you the right name.
Well, I know you were born in the New York Queens, if I'm not mistaken.
I was born in Ozone Park.
Ozone Park? In the Queens area?
In the Queens area, directly in the Queens area.
But you, fairly young, moved to the Florida.
When I was five,
also.
I moved down to the South Florida, to the South Florida.
Margate?
Margate was the place. Mm-hmm. And this was about a half hour north of Fort Lauderdale.
Sure.
And
so you're right in the underbelly
of spring break.
Spring break.
That's right.
From age six, you're there.
They made everyone watch Where the Boys Are, 84, as soon as you go to Margate, just so you're familiar with the Fort Lauderdale area. Yeah, I was very close to Fort Lauderdale, and it was nice growing up down there. But after a while, I just kind of got bored with Florida. No offense, Florida, but I just got, you know, I was born in New York, and I think I just needed to get back there, so.
How did the Simpsons refer to Florida? The nation's
dong?
America's Wang.
America's Wang.
Really, I have a friend of mine that also calls it that. I wonder which came first.
And I'm sorry. So you moved to Florida when you were five.
Yeah.
Without the family, I found out.
But
yeah. But, moved, got kicked out.
But you were such a city kid. You were so used to, you know, the bar scene.
Oh, the bar scene, the tough corners.
Being able to hail a cab.
Yeah. I couldn't get any good pizza down there in
Margate. Riding the subway.
You know, ride the subway.
Yeah, there's no good public transportation.
All of it.
The Manny Brothers wouldn't be there until... Yeah, sometime in the 90s, probably.
I missed the speakeasies. So I had to get back to New York. I
understand.
To New York at five. I was the most annoying kid in kindergarten because I couldn't stop talking about it.
How do you people do this?
How do you do it? How do you sit there and lie on a mat and take a nap? Give me a break with the building blocks.
Yeah. You know, a decent slice of pizza.
all that kidding aside, what the hell kind of a kid were you?
I was
No,
I wasn't a troubled kid. I was a bit of a overachiever and pretty a goody two shoes, really. I
wanted to please.
Wanted to please for sure. Yeah. I think that's where it all began. Never really got in trouble. Always was afraid of authority or wanted to please authority.
Right.
A well-behaved kid, but also, you know, growing up in an Italian-Irish family, humor was a big part of the gatherings.
A way out.
A way out, as it were.
And a way in.
And it and I think it kind of tailored my performances a bit.
Funny family.
Great, funny family. My dad's a terrific storyteller, great at jokes. My mom just not so good at telling stories, can tell a story, but just not, that's not where I got the performance side.
Well, I mentioned the scene stealers catching my eye at a very young age. Did you have any of that? Were you, is there anyone that was?
At a young age, it was stand-ups and comedians, and the like Carlin and Eddie Murphy, Delirious, and those were ideally what I think attracted me to comedy. And then movies, I was, you know, I was Jaws. So there were character actors. Like I remember Richard Dreyfuss being one of the first guys that I picked up as a kid watching because of his energy. And then as I got a little bit older, there were just great character actors like Warren Oates that I fell in love with. And, you know, Hulka was my introduction to him and then saw his other amazing movies.
Sergeant Hulka.
Sergeant Hulka from Stripes. For
I've
those
got
that
a
don't know.
War Notes quote.
Yeah.
I'd like you to explain.
Okay.
You once stated, quote, mm-hmm. I'm going to wait till you sip because I don't want anything come flying out of you.
No spittakes here.
I'd like to become the War Notes of comedy, if that's at all possible. Do you remember why you said this? It involves mustache.
I was going to say a few glasses of whiskey.
Mustache.
That might have been the reason I said
it
that.
It started with mustache acting.
Oh, yes, yes, I do remember now. I love facial hair when I do my characters, and it's become kind of a joke among friends, and mainly my girlfriend, who would be like, so what are you growing for this one? Is it going to be sideburns? And I think at the time, I was doing Reno and had the crazy Fu Manchu, and I think Warren was sporting that in Hired Hand, his old movies. I think it was that. I don't think it was Cockfighter. But anyway, and so I think that was on my brain. And, you know, just wanted really to bring attention to Warren Oates.
Because that's what I thought when I read the quote during, when I was going through J-Mac's research to put together today's dossier.
I love that you have a dossier. I love that word. Go on.
I love Warren Oates, and it was Sergeant Hulka also that stood out. No facial hair on the sergeant. So I wondered, how did he tie Warren Oates into mustache acting and tried to remember any role I possibly could with Warren Oates? And I thought, you know what? I'll bet he's just a fan of Warren Oates.
That's the short answer.
And Warren Oates in Stripes also is shocking in the sense that he was a very serious actor.
Yeah.
I don't think of him comedically.
Absolutely. And yeah. I think that, I mean, I don't know, but I feel like that might have been around the time where, like, serious actors kind of jumped in to those types of comedies, those broader comedies, you know. And, you know, I was amazed that Leslie Nielsen was a dramatic actor at first. I didn't realize that because, of course, I knew him from Airplane and Police Squad. And when I found out that he actually was a terrific dramatic actor, it blew my mind.
Yeah, almost a separate first career.
Yeah.
Matthau as well, right?
Matthau. Yeah, and Lemon both. Well, they got to go back and forth quite a bit.
He was another hero on Matthau for many reasons, but also just that era where someone who could look like Matthau did.
Like a dog's ass.
Like a dog's ass. A studio could say, yep, he's the lead. Yeah, sure, let's get him in. How about he plays a doctor that goes to answer, you know, makes house calls, and the ladies love him because he's such a Lothario? Walter Matthau. That's preposterous. Like, I mean, so I miss that. Although I guess there's a few arguments you can make for some of today's comic actors that are funny but maybe not pretty that are now getting.
Let's go down the list.
Yes, Katherine Heigl never would have totally gone through with Seth Rogen's baby insider. Yeah, let's call a spade a spade.
Sure, for sure. Yeah.
Let's call a Rogen a Rogen.
Let's call a Rogen a Rogen. Love him like a brother, but nobody's having his kid. Come on.
Yeah, I mean, you always had the sort of Jack Black guys.
Right, yes, right? Yes.
Over the years. But if you're going to be a romantic lead.
Right.
For almost the whole run of the cinematic history,
you're not going to go directly to Matthau.
You don't go to.
Or even action, if you can call, like, taking Pelham 1-2-3 an action movie, but that too, you know, he was our main guy.
Yeah. Well, these guys caught my eye too, so it's great to hear that the next generation felt the same way.
Yeah.
They were character actors, and they got to do such a wide range.
So much, and what was great was that discovering them late in their career, it was great to go back and check all their early movies. Even Christofferson, who's not really a character actor, more lead, but like, you know, Convoy was where I saw him. And he ended up being in my favorite movie of all time, which has a plethora of great character actors, Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. And so then I was like, wow, Slim Pickens and R.G. Armstrong and you know, all these amazing, and L.Q. Jones. And I'm like, that's I want to do that kind of
L.Q.
acting.
Jones.
Yeah.
Isn't he the guy that comes in and busts Sam Rothstein's balls in Casino?
Yes.
Saying, your kind come and go.
Yeah.
This is our show.
That's
town.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
I
right.
I love L.Q.
Terrific. And so, I have a shirt that has, like, Christofferson, Warren Oates, and Harry Dean Stanton, and Stacey Keach from Fat City. And so, I just love those guys.
May I ask why these people are on a T-shirt that you own?
Yes. There's a plug. There's a terrific website called Built by Wendy, and she draws recreates scenes from movies, some good movies, as well as collages of those types of character actors. She has a scene from like Bad News Bears with Lupus in the garbage, and a Willy Wonka scene when he's talking to Charlie at the end. And one of them was this foursome of those guys that just kind of nailed all my favorites. And she had another one that were like British tough guys, and I think it had Malcolm McDowell and some of the other some of those guys, and Michael Caine, I think, and just, you know, really great drawing on the shirt.
Right.
Because I was an illustrator and liked to draw, that also.
Yeah, I saw that you love the Mad Magazine, also something we have in the common.
Mm-hmm.
And then you started to actually create a couple of your own comics?
I did.
How old are you at this point?
I was 12 or 13. I was in sixth grade, and me and a couple of friends, Donald Dalbora, John D'Agostino. I just love remembering names from high school. You just do. They just stick there.
Couple
and
more
Mike
Italian.
Bartberger, yeah, created Crud Magazine. So we had to get a mascot like Alfred E. Newman, and I think we got a Melvin Crud, who was kind of a crazy scientist, and then we had an editor named Spencer Drool, who had a big crack in his skull. And I always drew as a kid, and so it was a natural progression, I think, was to create a Mad Magazine type thing. And then we would run copies off in middle school, and the teachers loved it, because I guess it was pretty soft. Uh-huh. It wasn't too edgy or
wasn't
profane.
Or crumb?
Yeah, it wasn't. Shape. It wasn't crumb. There were no gigantic, big boobed women that he was piggybacking. I did that off, you know, on campus. You know, not on the magazine itself.
Sure, sure.
I just would find big women to piggyback.
Sure.
On.
In fact, we have footage of that.
Here we
show
go.
That.
Cut to.
Nope.
No.
No.
I guess that was an outright lie.
Also, at this time, you were shooting some horror movies, I understand.
Yeah.
What the hell? What does that mean?
I was, I had the Super 8 camera, and I...
Back up a little bit.
Yeah.
You say to your dad, I'd like one of these, or you save up some money and get one yourself? How does the Super 8 camera end up in your hands?
Let me,
yeah. Stole it.
They had one. No, they had a Super 8 camera
your
for
parents
home. My parents had one for their home movies.
Sure.
And so I had theirs and took theirs, and I think I used that. And then another friend of mine at the time had a Super 8, and so we used two. And
or even then, you were shooting with two cameras.
Yes, that's right. That's right. We had coverage.
Sure.
I needed coverage, and it was just the eye line that I always messed up at 11 or 12. So yeah, we had two cameras there, and I was loved horror movies. Again, very young. I knew it was kind of weird, but didn't...
What early horror movies were grabbing you?
I think the first one I remember seeing, the first horror movie that I saw was on HBO called Piranha. It was Joe Dante's Piranha, and I think that movie was 78. I could be wrong, but HBO aired it in 79. I remember that was a big one. I had to ask permission. Can I, you know, it's an R-rated movie. And
Sam, you want to get on that?
Yeah.
Piranhas? Joe
yeah,
Dante?
Get on that. make sure I got my facts right.
Yeah. It sounded right to me.
Yeah?
You know we don't like our guests to be wrong. Because then they get yelled
at. Joe and I had a long talk about this before the show.
We did, didn't we?
We did.
You fucking did.
I warned you.
Yes.
I warned you.
I'm going to get you. I'm going to get you on a fact. This might be the one.
So you had to ask permission to watch Piranhas?
Yeah, which was granted very graciously.
78, nicely done.
Ah, excellent.
And then you're just there, you're dialed in.
Then I'm in, dialed in. And I hadn't seen Jaws yet at that point, and that was the big one I wanted to see because my parents were going out to see it. Can I please come?
You're a child.
I'm a child, yeah, you know. You're not, it's about a shark that eats people, no. Oh, a shark that eats people.
Florida.
I'm in. We're in Florida, come on. And so Piranha was as close as I was able to get at that point.
To an eating fish.
Not just one big one.
No.
Thousands of little ones.
Yeah. It takes
they soften
bites.
The blow uh-huh. for me. Yeah.
But in terms of the idea of making your own horror movies.
Well.
I mean, it's one thing to go see
to
one.
To go see one.
Because I remember, I was mesmerized going to movies as a kid. And I would walk around as someone in the film for a couple of days.
Yeah.
But the idea of making my own films never crossed my mind. I mean, that's...
Well, I think I started making the horror movies after Piranha, because I think it was when I did see Jaws, which was maybe a couple years after that on cable. That was the first time where
I was asking myself, how do they do that? It was beyond now, suddenly, like, I'm watching a movie. It was like, I want to do that. I started to be interested in how to, yeah, the puzzle. How were they able to do that? So, oh, well, then you need a camera, and you need these special effects. And so I think it was somewhere around there. Mm. And then I was sucked in. Then I was like, I just want to do movies. I want to make movies.
At this point, you meet Robert Shaw.
And then I met Robert Shaw down in Margate, Florida.
Got him to come to Margate.
He was at the Pompano Fashion Square Mall at the Orange Julius. And I said, Robert.
Bobby.
And he just sneered at me. Bobby, how's the Julius?
He was saying, can you put some vodka in this, man?
That's right.
I'm asking you for the last time.
So now we're at the Coconut Creek High School.
Now we're at Coconut Creek High School.
Well, let's go to Coconut Creek.
Oh boy, would have loved me then. I was a package. acid wash jeans.
Keep talking.
Capizios, cuffs jeans, Ocean Pacific shirt, pastels, earring.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah. I believe you wore this Ocean Pacific shirt to
That's right, for your party.
For the
80s thing, which was so great. And because that was me. I was a very serious kid.
You got laid every day.
Oh, no. They laid me down and said, stay there.
And they laid you out.
And laid me out.
You were a very serious kid. I was told that, too. I don't remember it, but I was told
I don't
was
either,
a very
but I was, yeah.
Kid.
I mean, I was funny. I was a naturally funny kid and made people laugh, but really inside, I was a very serious kid. And it was about doing the yearbook editor in the Honor Society and the captain of the swim team, and just get all the things.
You got to be focused.
And if you do it right, then you get everything you want. I realized you could do that without having to be the yearbook editor. Captain of the swim team.
Really?
Yeah.
Somebody else was on the swim team.
Yeah.
I seem to recall.
Yes, a dear friend and great actor by the name of Bobby Cannavale.
Bobby Cannavale.
Who I've known since I was 15 years old, and we were both on the swim team together, and we also were in plays together. And we talk about this all the time to each other, that we try to upstage each other on stage. That was how it worked. We tried to literally steal the focus and jokes away from the other. We were a competitive, a healthy and unhealthy kind of competition, I suppose. But we just went at it on stage and then also happened to be on the swim team. And I found that was the only sport, because I walked a fine line between getting along with the drama people and getting along with the sports people.
The jocks.
The jocks. Yeah.
The funny and people, I find, this is our lot in life. We're the go-between. Warring factions
that
never get anywhere near each other.
No.
Hence, some might suggest freaks and geeks, but there's always these peer groups.
There's a gatherer.
This is why we have Facebook, clearly. But there's always these peer groups. You either belong or you don't. How else can I feel left out?
Yeah.
Right? And it seems like the funny people were a bit of a conduit.
It's a great tool. It was a great tool to have that I kind of discovered pretty early on and used. And so I was able to kind of walk both sides of that very thin line. Well, actually, very wide line.
Right.
Yeah.
I
wide gap.
I never drifted all the way into the drama freaks, as they were called in my day, back when they invented fire. but I do remember everyone kind of did Godspell at some point, and Godspell was my senior year.
Yeah.
And the fact that there were football players in the front row crying at one point during the drama freaks backstage were like, thank you, Kevin.
Yeah,
You brought the jocks here, and we all got to make them cry. And we
they were genuinely moved.
As it turns out.
Or crying because they just wanted to get the hell out of there and didn't want to.
They were uncomfortable.
They were uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Yeah. Musicals I never really was a fan of.
Yeah.
I
that's where you and Sam connect.
Are you not a fan of musicals either?
Can't stand them.
I just never, they just seem so ridiculous to me. And there's great musicals. And I watched Grease, you know. I was a big fan of Grease, but like theater musicals, I never bought the breakout into the song. I just thought it was absolutely ridiculous.
I asked you a question. I didn't ask for a song.
That's right. And
answer the question.
I don't care what you did earlier when you were walking down the street.
Yeah.
Or why you're upset about why she doesn't like you.
Right. Oh, you love her?
Just tell me that.
Just say I love her. Yeah. I don't need 10 dudes in a whole show. I don't need it.
So I never got that. I mean, that's, I love doing karaoke with friends.
As it turns out, you are quite fond of the singing.
Yes.
And the silly singing.
That's the irony of it, is it's just not the musicals.
Yeah. What age were you when the karaoke grabbed you and wouldn't let go?
Oh, that was pretty late. That was pretty late. The karaoke...
later in New York.
Yeah, that was, you know, early mid-20s. Mm-hmm. It's a fairly new you know, 10 or so years ago. And, you know, maybe it's the part of me that wanted to like the musicals that I've been repressing that
but
suddenly wanted to
I've
sing.
I've seen you in action. There's a fearlessness about you when you're attacking the karaoke.
That's true.
Which is the only way to do it.
That's the, you don't have to sing well. You just have to commit to
it. You have to commit.
There's got
to
be commitment. And if you commit out of key, you win.
Yeah.
You win.
Well,
the people listening to you do not win.
This is what Sammy does better than most I've seen, is the committing to out of off key.
Yeah. Is that right?
Well, and it's not on purpose. Yeah. This ear doesn't hear the way it should.
Randy Jackson would say you're a little pitchy.
I'm a little pitchy, dog. Yeah. As long as it sounds good to me.
That's right.
You gotta sell a song at karaoke. You don't necessarily have to be able to sing well. You gotta pick a crowd pleaser, and you gotta sell the shit out of that song.
Unless you don't necessarily have to pick a crowd pleaser if you're in a room with friends.
Right.
This is what Joe specializes.
Then, which is my, because I actually don't like the public karaoke scene, because then it does become about a performance and what's the vibe of the room. Yeah. Oh, I gotta sing November Rain, which, by the way, you never do. The rule. It just should be a sign on the door. November Rain, American Pie, Bohemian Rhapsody. And there's one that I'm forgetting.
I'm sick of Don't Stop Believin'. If I hear Don't Stop Believin' one more
that's
time.
That's close, but the other ones are just long anthems. And Paradise by the Dashboard Lights. Those are the four.
Whitney Houston song, God Rest Her Soul.
Mm-hmm.
Ladies, you're not going to pull it off.
That's right.
Put the rest today. Today was the day when...
That's why I said God rest her soul.
Eulogies took place. And
may she rest in peace.
So thanks for bringing her into the show.
Way to go.
You know, I try to keep it topical.
And
I don't like these shows to be evergreen, Kevin.
That's what you do.
8-9 years from now, I want someone to go, oh my God, is Whitney Houston died? This is so old.
So when you're at the high school, is that when the theater group 2617 happens?
Yeah. Yes, that was the...
I'm gonna need to, is that you and Bobby Cannavale fucking off?
No, that's me fucking off.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, that's me fucking off. That was the, there was a person that was in that troupe with me and put that up on my IMDb page, which was fine, but I just thought it was hilarious that he put the troupe number, as if anyone cares, one that I was part of the thespian club, but also the troupe number. Oh, 21... 26, let's see, that was John was in that one. It was Keith Phillips. Let's see. Oh, 21, 26, 17. Sure, I remember that troop. I remember that group. Oh, I'm so glad they put that down. And
was it a sketch group? What was it?
I think it was just the chapter. It was the chapter of the National Thespian Society that was assigned to Coconut Creek High School for that year. And we went to a state competition, I wish I could remember his name. I want to say Russell, somebody. But we did a scene from Say Goodnight Gracie.
Mm-hmm.
And my approach to acting then, because I did it for Don't Drink the Water as well in high school, was just do Jackie Gleason. If you do Jackie Gleason, it'll be funny.
He's funny.
Because he's funny.
Right.
And if you do that voice, well, then it's going to work. People will buy it.
Uh-huh.
It didn't matter that it was the weirdest thing coming out of a 5'5 kid, you know, that voice. It didn't matter.
Age 16?
Age 16, yeah. That didn't matter. Just do a good Gleason.
Or a play that Jackie actually had never done himself.
That's right. Although, was he in Don't Drink the Water?
Oh, yes, of course.
Maybe it was the film version.
Well,
maybe
yeah,
you know.
I'm sure that was the case.
But yes.
But you didn't care. That wasn't
real. No. I wasn't going to get into specifics.
That was all the acting.
Yeah.
Was the dude in the Gleason voice?
Yeah, well, those two performances stood out because the other ones I am remembering from high school was like Little Abner, a musical, which I was not excited about. And I think I just did a terrible Southern accent for that. I might have done like Boss Hogg or whatever I was watching on TV at the time. I'm thinking Dukes of Hazzard. So my approach to acting then was mostly voices and imitation, I think.
And did anyone come up to you after the show and say, good Gleason?
No.
Never called out on it.
No.
So you pulled it off, and they thought it was a character.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure they were thinking that. I'm sure they were like doing Gleason, but they, I guess, didn't want to make
he's
a 16-year-old feel uncomfortable.
Why should he cry?
Let's give it. Why not give him a plastic trophy and say congrats, as opposed to Gleason, man, Jackie Gleason, gotcha. Go home to Coconut Creek.
What the good God? So. Is it around this time you're thinking, I got to go to NYU? This is ridiculous.
Yeah.
I can't spend the rest of my days in 2617.
No. I can't hang out with the Thespian Troupe 2617. I started looking at film schools. I wanted to be an actor. I knew I wanted to be in the business.
You had the fever.
I had the fever.
You've been on stage.
Yeah.
You've gotten the laughs.
I got the laughs.
You upstaged Cannavale.
Yeah, that's right. I got past Cannavale. And won a lot of the joke contests there. Why not go full force into acting?
So you mentioned that stand-ups kind of inspired you, but did you ever give that a shot?
No, I was too afraid.
Refused.
No, I was afraid.
To stand alone.
To stand alone. I needed to do characters, and obviously I could have done some stand-up, routine with a character or something, but that never appealed to me. What appealed to me was really dramatic acting. I never even comedy, which I didn't see any like Monty Python sketches until like college. I didn't really watch old SNL. Like I'd seen maybe some things, but I was
technically there were new SNLs on at the time. The show never
yeah, but this is what the late 80s.
This is late 80s.
You don't want to watch SNL in the late 80s.
The Gene Dominion years.
Yeah,
but the first cast. I didn't watch the classic things, the sketches, and so I wanted to be a Pacino or De Niro, and that was what I was going to do.
Or Gleason.
It's weird. I didn't do De Niro or Pacino in the plays. No, Gleason. And so comedy, I lost my train of thought.
No, you're going to NYU to actually pursue the idea of film school.
Film school,
And that's acting as well, or was it really back?
It was really, I didn't want to go into an acting department because I was very self-absorbed and arrogant and didn't want to learn any one way how to act. I think acting, there could be many different ways to act. You don't have to do method. You don't have to do Adler. I don't want to be poisoned by a school of thought on how to act because I'm just going to do instinct. Blah, blah, blah.
You talked at 17?
Yeah, I used to just talk like John Travolta. I just did this, like I got sick to my stomach. And so it was weird. I didn't even know what I was doing. But and so I didn't want to go into any kind of department. And so I'm just going to go into the film school and make movies, and then I'll act how I want to act if I am lucky enough to get in front of the camera.
Well, recently at the Sketchfest in the San Francisco, during the stage reading of Hot, Wet American Summer. Mm.
Close.
Sexy.
That's all I have to
close
do.
Close enough.
Close.
This is another thing. You can
Wet, Hot American Summer.
Thank you. It's been
I'm hot, wet. It's wet, hot. Gotcha. While you were on stage, I think Jamie and I shared that we felt a little bit of Michael Keaton's energy from early in his film career.
My goodness, that's
so I have to
a big
ask,
thing to say.
It's quite the compliment.
Yes.
I have to ask if there was ever a moment of inspiration from what he was doing in your Night Shift, your Beetlejuice, your
Night,
Mr.
Yes,
Mom.
For sure. Night Shift, I used to just do impressions of like, love brokers! absolutely. And I was drawn to his, I was drawn to his energy. Like it just seemed
kinetic.
So contagious and kinetic, and I was kind of a hyper kid anyway. I'm not at all comparing myself to him, but like that type of energy
I did that for you.
It was appealing. His energy was appealing to me.
I was just curious if you were inspired by him.
Absolutely.
Not suggesting you were ripping him off the way he did with Jackie Gleason all those years. Because Michael's energy was something I'm not sure we had seen before.
Mm-hmm.
We'd seen probably close to it in other in other performers, but there was a little bit of danger mm-hmm. behind his energy. That
I agree. Yeah, I did notice that. Although I don't think I kind of kind of process it like that. Right. I just didn't know what he was going to do next. Because he was funny, but then he had these moments where he's not.
You just did the classic Michael
Keaton. And that was very fascinating for me to watch. Yeah, he was absolutely an inspiration.
So you get your ass to New York, to the NYU.
Get up there to NYU.
You're going
to
be very serious.
Mm-hmm.
Self-described, pretentious.
Yeah, yeah, very much into
You want to be a great filmmaker.
Mm-hmm, all of it.
And how do you go from there, that headspace, to sketch comedy? Because we are at polar opposites, perhaps.
Yeah, because you're saying you were...
No, not we. We're those of us who are looking at this moment in your life.
Oh, I see. I
see you saying, yes, being very serious, I'm mm-hmm. going to be a filmmaker, to sort of the wacky hijinks of sketch comedy.
What happened was that Michael Showalter, who was the first person I met at college, lived right across from my dorm, was in the dorm across from me. And we became fast friends, and there he was going to see a sketch show. That he dragged me to. I didn't really want to go see it, but it was that freshman year, and yeah, I want to make friends. And
in fact, it sounded awful to you.
I wasn't interested at all, truly. Yes. Like, I really wasn't. I was like, let's go, I don't know, let's go around New York, let's try to get, let's go drinking, or I don't know what it was, but that wasn't it. I was not interested in that.
Did he have three cats even then?
Do they have four? Yes, he did. Yes. He opened the door, and a flood of cats came out of the dorm room. Weinstein is known for their cat people. He loved cats. I don't know why I'm thinking of this, but I remember one walk that I had with Showalter. He was talking about how much he loved James Taylor. And I remember at the time, my musical tastes were terrible. I didn't really... I was thinking, when he said James Taylor, I was thinking James Ingram.
Sure.
And the fact that I would even, one, know James Ingram, or listen to him, or confuse him with James Taylor, I thought was strange. But anyway, that popped in my head. He took me to this show, which was very funny. And David Wayne was in this group, it's called the Sterile Yak. And then they were having, after the show was over, they said they were going to have auditions. Not immediately after the show, but they wanted to start a new group, and Showalter demanded that I put my name on the list for the auditions.
You were aghast at this notion originally.
I didn't want to do it. Yeah, I didn't want to do
did
it.
Did you like the show?
I did like. Yeah. Yeah, I did like the show. Yeah, it was.
But there wasn't a moment of epiphany.
No, and which was odd. I think I was still in my, I want to do serious work.
You were going to be Orson Welles.
Yes.
Let's be honest.
Yes, I was going to be Orson Welles. Yeah. I was going to...
Which not even he could pull off.
That's right. I was going to have films that were taught in film classes.
Right. It's amazing. Let's
17.
Be serious.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've heard of Coconut Creek High.
Yeah, but how we do it down there, we don't mess around with this comedy stuff.
Yeah.
You know, we don't tap dance for anyone.
I love that you fought it at first. So he insists that you audition, or...
He encouraged me, yeah. He's like, let's just do it. And I said, yeah, all right. And it was the auditions were being run by Todd Hollebeck, who was in this group, the Stereoyak, and then started this this new group. And the audition, I forgot what I did. I don't even know if it was... I think it might have been a monologue.
As Gleason.
It was either Gleason, or I also did a monologue in high school that I hope I didn't use for the audition, but I did William Hurt's Children of a Lesser God.
I'm going to need just 90 seconds of that, if it's possible.
You need to answer me. Talk to me. Something like that. I was into learning. I learned sign language. Had to.
Uh-huh.
And acting. Good acting wasn't really what you were feeling and saying. It was how hard I hit my hand or this to do the sign language.
Yeah.
Because that meant I meant it and was feeling something. So I hope that I did that for the audition for the State New Group. I don't think I did, but it was...
You might have chosen something comedic.
I might have chosen something comedic, but I probably did, but that would have been the right
one to do because it was ridiculously funny. Except I didn't know it at the time.
Right.
You know.
So were you shocked when they said, please join us? Or were you relieved or excited?
I was excited because it was a new, it was a group of people.
Peer group.
It was a peer group.
Right. Make friends.
Yeah. And I had, I immediately started to compartmentalize my friends as soon as I got to college. I do that throughout my life.
Well, that's what a very serious kid does.
Yeah, I got these friends and this friends, and now I got my roommate, and now some people I met at the mixer, and now I have the new comedy people. The mixer. You know, the freshman orientation mixer.
You've already mentioned a few people from the comedy sketch experience.
Yes.
Who are great friends of yours to this day.
To this day.
So I have to ask.
Yeah.
How many folks on the mixer are you still close to?
There is zero. There's no one there from the mixer. No. I don't think any of the people from the group were at the mixer I was at. And so I don't... That compartment was put in
I'm surprised
in drawer,
a fellow like yourself
yeah.
didn't stay close with anyone he had met at anything called the mixer.
I really did. I'm thinking... I didn't, to this day. I have high school friends, besides Bobby, that I still...
Mm-hmm. But the mixer sounds like the first version of J-Date.
No, it did not.
The mixer.
Just because it's at NYU, you assume they're all Jews? Jesus,
no, son of a... Just, you son of a bitch.
Just the mixer sounds like something yeah. Jews in their 50s go yeah. to. You're brand new at NYU college, yeah, university. Yeah. I go to the mixer.
I like to throw out words from the 50s every now and then. Old stuff, uh-huh. Lollygagging.
Sure.
Yeah, I don't remember anyone from the mixer.
We like to involve the audience. I want to go to them if you don't mind.
I don't.
Just for a little follow-up.
I'd love to hear
on
from
the
you.
Wet, hot American. Mm-hmm. Topic, mm-hmm. as opposed to the hot wet. This one comes to us from the Twitter feed at BPendy or BPendy. Ask Joe about the Wet Hot American prequel.
Ah.
And tell him I love him. Maybe a backpack too.
Maybe a backpack too.
Pat.
Oh, maybe a pat back too. Yeah.
B. Pendy loves you and would like to give you a pat on the back.
Oh, I see. Now my brain
I've
is working
again.
I've
not heard anything about a hot or wet prequel.
There has been talk, mm-hmm. and I don't know...
How much you can say?
How much I can say, or whether... I know that myself, the cast, I think all the cast, and David Wayne and Michael Showalter, the creators of the original, want to do one. And so I'm hoping it happens... And I won't give too much away because I want to lead to another story that is stemming from this prequel, which is that Showalter kind of emailed me and wanted to get some information about my character, Neil. I had some thoughts about it if this prequel were to happen. And I said, oh, that's a good idea. I don't want to give away the idea. I'm being very abstract. I'm going to come back.
Cool.
It's going to make sense. I had to look through some old journals because there's an incident that may happen in the prequel that actually happened to me. Neil is trying to lose. I don't want to.
Don't give anything away.
In fact,
put a pin in the whole damn thing and tell me about.
Yeah, let's
you journaling.
I don't want to interrupt. It's just yes, David. Yes, I'm sorry. I'm waiting with this phone.
He
yes,
came in.
I will do the prequel. I'm really excited to be on camera this time. Okay, thanks so much for calling. All right, love to you. Goodbye. I just, sorry.
Sam
about
Levine,
that.
The voice of Artie from Wet Hot.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. The journal, I'll get to the journal.
You keeping a journal, were you?
I was. At like 16, I started pretty early. And the journal entry that I looked over it was about me losing my virginity. And I wrote that journal entry in the third person.
No, you didn't.
Whoa. I sure did. And so...
as a way to be objective?
Nope, as a way to glorify it and picture someone reading it years when they uncover it after the apocalypse and realize how brilliant
this man had sex.
And wow, and yet he wrote it from the perspective of the narrator. It was the most ridiculous journal entry I'd ever read, but it really explained how serious I was at the time. Like And I'll give you another little nugget. After it happened, immediately after it happened, me and my girlfriend at the time,
hot and wet,
held each other,
sure,
standing up in front, looking at ourselves in the mirror.
Why?
Just because it was so special. What we had done was so special. And then
one of you said, "Let's get out of bed."
Given me.
Honey.
I don't know. I think it was so quick. It was so like it was done, and then we were up, and then we wanted a hug, and then we turned around, and then we're in front of a mirror. And true story. And then I say to our reflection, "Hey, you." She says, "Hey, you." End of journal entry. True story, everyone. I'm not afraid to say it because
that is glorious.
But it was, yeah, and that kind of shows you how serious I was about, like, we had just shared this really special thing, and let's just own it.
Hey, you.
There it goes in Travolta again.
Mm-hmm.
That's not Travolta.
So you passed that along to Showalter?
I passed that information for him to use.
Do with it what you will.
That's right.
Okay.
Who knows if we'll see it, but take it.
All right, let's jump around a little bit.
Yep.
The sketch comedy group that grows from that audition, before it becomes The State on MTV, it is just on campus, or you guys are
just
moving around
campus.
Town? Just on campus.
It started out just on campus, not an improv group.
Sketch.
Just sketch.
Yeah.
And
Thomas Lennon was here, told us some of it.
Yeah.
His experience, shed some of his drug-infused crazy days. You were quoted as saying during those days, there was a Jaeger-induced midnight sidewalk stencil mission.
Yes, there was.
That took place on occasion.
Yes, there was.
I'd like to hear just a little bit more about that.
I'd be happy to tell you. Mm-hmm. We loved to drink back in the day, sometimes today, sometimes now. Back in college, and Ben Garant and I drank a bottle of Jägermeister.
A bottle? Between the two of you?
Yeah. There might have been another. Tom might have been with us. I just remember there was two or three of us. And I had made a stencil. And the only way to promote the group, we felt, was to spray it on the sidewalk. Forget flyers. We did those. But we wanted
to. Boring.
Yeah, it's boring.
When
people were, you know, walking down New York, staring at their feet, hurrying along their way, maybe they'll go across this sign. And so on the corner throughout the campus, we sprayed. It just said New Group. That was the name of the state before we became the state. And then woke up the next day and kind of snickered to ourselves about it. We were really into the idea of not only promoting the group, but being bad boys. Really being edgy and rebellious. Yeah, we just pulled a graffiti move and defaced public property, you know, for the sake of a sketch show.
Yeah,
that was the thing. Like we would do that. We would.
I think the Bansky started the same way.
The
you mean Banksy?
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Okay.
The Banksy. Yeah.
You're the worst.
That makes me the best. If I got it right every time, I'd be full of shit.
You put
this way,
the
I'm Homer
in front of
an
anything,
idiot.
It's gonna work.
Yeah.
The Banksy.
The Banksy started the same way, stenciling. New Group.
All over. There was actually a theater company called New Group in New York at the time, which we didn't even realize.
We didn't acknowledge.
So we kind of were doing a favor to them as well, I guess, or not.
By the way, so you know, and for the record, when I come across a thought like that, a reference that pops into my head, and my head says it about seven times before it comes out,
yeah,
it tries seven different versions of Banksy before it says it incorrectly the one time.
Oh, I see.
It tries, is it Bansy? Banksy? Banksy?
That's why I love you.
Yeah. It is auditioning some choices.
You were. It was going through. You had like a little Rolodex.
Yeah, I threw it around a little bit.
thinking yeah. I'm gonna say this wrong.
Right.
In fact, on that one, it actually threw out an announcement like a bat signal.
You were absolutely gonna say this wrong. Ding, ding.
Yeah.
Oh, and, so you knew.
And I said it anyways.
I'm a notorious mispronouncer.
Are you?
Yeah, that's always been, it drives my girlfriend crazy too. There's just certain words
beef?
That I just.
Talking about beef?
Beef, talking about beef. Beef, my girlfriend, beef. My girlfriend, beef. My father has a few words as well, and I think not to throw him, in front of the bus, sorry, Dad. Has a few words, and I think that he just mispronounces, and I too, and my brother. I think it's just genetic.
I wonder if it is becoming the father because it was a big part of Homer's and remains part of his personality as a way to relate to all fathers. I've told the story here many times of my dad meeting George Lucas for the first time and saying, "I really love DT." It happens,
yeah.
And now it's happening constantly. Mm-hmm. But it's nice to hear that it's happening at your age as well. But while you broke into a little character there, I wanted to ask, when it came to the high-talking, high-voice character on the I Love You Man, is this something that's in the script? Is this something you bring in? Fellas, here's something I want to try.
No, that was, I believe, in the script.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was John Hamburg. And so I think, though, what wasn't in... I hope I'm not getting this wrong. What wasn't in the script, I think the Everything You Got... I think that was in the audition that I brought. But the high voice, the voice itself was Hamburg. He'd put that out, and I was afraid I was going to lose my voice when I did that movie because we were at the Galaxy game, and for the entire game, I'm screaming in that high voice. I thought I was just going to,
You're not going to get much of that from your diaphragm.
You know why?
Even if you knew how to.
I didn't go to the training because I was too good for it. I didn't want to go to the good trauma school to learn technique.
Nope.
Yeah. But a lot of people in the stadium didn't know what the hell was going on and were really getting tired of me screaming. So that was kind of fun. And then when they put Paul and I've told this story before, so I'll make it quick. When they put Paul Rudd and I up on the Jumbotron, everyone just started booing because they were into the game and also didn't know that we were shooting a movie.
Right.
And I don't know if you've ever been booed by 50,000 people, but it's awesome. It's awesome. It really is. It's so humbling. And like, we just started laughing as soon as it started happening.
Every time he plays the road, he knows what it's like.
Yeah.
It's weird. He plays these massively filled stadiums.
Yeah. I insist
they
on
can't
playing.
Stand them.
Right. That's right.
First of all, they're all free. You never get laughs from free seats.
No.
Right?
No.
How else am I going to get 50,000 people to show up anywhere but to paper the room? And then you get booed. And it's like,
but have you
why
been
are you
booed
doing this?
By like 10,000 people?
I had the scariest moment for me ever was in Gainesville, Florida, a place we visited in the opening of the show.
Uh-huh.
Some at the Gator Growl.
Ah.
In the swamp, right, where they have the big football game
yep.
for the Florida Gators.
Yep.
Their homecoming, they have a big show every year called Gator Growl.
Okay.
And
heard about it, my girl.
I mean, they've had Seinfeld, they've had everybody. So you get off the plane there in Gainesville, and they say, "You ever played in front of 90,000 people before?" And they ask it like everyone doesn't say, "Well, no," right? They ask it so sincerely.
It's
hey,
like,
"Have you ever played in front of 90,000 people before?"
Right.
I guess maybe they're waiting for one person to say,
well, "Oh yeah.
Yeah,
right."
So when you say no, they immediately chime in with "Bob Hope bombed." Smothers Brothers got booed off.
And this is how they hype you up. This is how they get you ready for...
Let me show you to the hotel. This is the greeting committee. How did you people get assigned?
Good luck, man. I wouldn't do it.
Yeah. It's at night. Spotlights in your eyes on stage. Mm-hmm. So bright, you can't see anyone in the audience. So, when you get to a punchline and 90,000 people are fortunate enough for you to laugh at the same time, it is an audible wave that is the single most frightening thing I've ever experienced in my life.
Yeah.
So doing well, the opposite of booing, much more frightening. You guys were laughing at being booed.
Yeah.
I shit myself.
Really?
So I don't know the sensation at all.
Yeah. It's.
I'll be on a Jumbotron, first of all.
Right.
That would be spectacular.
That alone. Well, that's great, just in and of itself.
Yeah.
I mean, and you're so big.
The fact that everyone sees it and their reaction is hatred.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, exactly. I couldn't get enough of it, actually.
My focus shifted because I was thinking about stand up again, and that feeling you're talking about, like getting that kind of laughter, and I remember getting that when I did theater in high school. That live.
The one-upmanship you and Cannavale?
Hearing a lot of people laugh in a room is really amazing. It's an amazing feeling.
Well, that was the thing actually that kind of surprised me is when you said you and Bobby had that in high school, where you were kind of one-upping each other. I assumed, perhaps foolishly, that it was not in a dramatic way that you were one-upping each other. You were going for the laugh.
Yeah.
That by the time you got to NYU, it was so foreign to you that someone would have to drag you to a sketch show. They're going to be funny? Why would I?
Right.
And then have to force you to audition. Come on, do it. There was a part of you hadn't held on to getting that laugh.
Right.
Boy, oh boy, as you said, is that powerful.
Yeah, it was. And I think ultimately I realized that's how I was going to get that feeling. I mean, why not do sketch comedy? Why not do comedy again? Because I can get that vibe. You know, I can feel that again. But like the stand-up, you know, stand-up was very scary to me and still is because I feel like you need to be really, you really have to open up about your private life if you want to be a really good stand-up, I feel. I feel like you really have to be an open person and talk about what's going on in your life that you don't like or like. But I'm a more private person, I think, which is why I do these characters. Right. It's a lot easier for me to kind of get all that out, but like once I start talking about my actual life in a stand-up where like that, I get tense, and it shows.
Well, that is very true of a great many dramatic serious actors.
Yeah,
I've met over the years who are absolutely horrified by the notion of standing on stage alone and not having a script.
Yeah.
So when you're doing sketch comedy, you've got a script.
Right.
Right. You're working with a team of others. Rehearsals?
Over and over again. I mean, we would just rehearse things into the ground. It was...
How big did the group get? Because by the time you got to the state, there was 47 of you.
Right? That's right. There was about 49 people in the state. As many states as there are states. There's only 49 states, right?
Lower.
I think it was as big as maybe 12 or 13 and ended up being 11. But the reason why it was so big was because the original idea of the group, Todd Hollebeck's idea for this new group, was that everyone was going to have a voice in this thing, whether it's as a filmmaker, whether it's as a monologuist, whether it's as a comedy writer, whether it's as a stand. It was like a big group, and so he wanted to create a bunch of different voices.
That's pretty cool.
It was very cool.
Especially for a serious filmmaker like yourself.
Yeah, so bring in, you know, although I didn't go in as the filmmaker, I went in as, you know, just as the actor. Half of us were in drama, half of us were in film, but Todd really wanted, that was the core idea of what this group was gonna be. And we all bought into it. We drank the Kool-Aid and we thought it was great. It was very democratic, and we were all for one and one for all. I think that's where our kind of ego came from, the safety in numbers thing, where we were just gonna, that started very early. I remember the attitude, because after the first show of the state, it went really well. We had a Breakfast Club parody in there, and we just had a lot of really fun.
Who were you in the Breakfast Club
parody? I was Emilio Estevez. Mm-hmm. I did the Emilio Estevez, win! And get dramatic about it. And then I had to pull the tape and pull the flesh and pull the flesh. The whole thing. And it went over really well. Sure. And then I remember I was sitting with Showalter in like the cafeteria having something, and some girl came up to me. She's like, "You guys, that was the most amazing show I've ever seen. That's the funniest thing I've ever seen in my life." And it was suddenly, you know, the seed of ego was boom, like, yeah, we were funny. And now... we're going to just take it all the way to the moon. We're taking down everyone. SNL will be the new Python. It all started for me anyway at that moment where after the success of that first show, look out. That was it. We were going to conquer the world.
How many shows on campus before you're all out of school and doing it around
New York? '88 is when we met and we were doing it for 3 years. We didn't get on MTV until '92, so about 4 years we were doing shows on campus, and then we would go off campus after a while. We went to the Space at Chase on 3rd Avenue, it was there at the time, the Gene Frankel Theater. It's all these spaces that were around the campus and weren't on campus. And we're there really until
we had a one of David Wayne's friends, who was a producer, brought in someone that was also a producer and agent, and we got signed. Who brought an agent from William Morris to go see one of our live shows, and we got signed. And then we got the MTV show called You Wrote It, You Watch It. This is before the actual stage show.
Right.
I'm talking really fast because I feel like everyone's heard this so many times. But I, maybe not.
That's okay.
Yeah.
It's okay because most of our fans have never used the internet before.
Ah! Okay.
As I've learned.
That's not true.
Or they've only used the internet.
No, this is...
They've never seen TV.
They've never seen television or the internet. They're a very closed-off people, but Kevin is far-reaching.
Uh-huh.
So they've read about him in book form.
Ah.
And thought, I saw,
you had one of those. What are they called? Books? You had one of those earlier.
Yeah.
Right.
Uh-huh. So, this is new to our fans.
Okay. All right, good.
Don't worry about it.
Speaking of our fans, I want to bring him back in, if we may.
Yes, please.
We spoke a little bit about the Wanderlust.
Mm-hmm.
At Professor_D, this question seems perhaps Wanderlust related.
Okay.
What's your go-to don't get excited thought when filming nude, or do you consider such a situation an occupational hazard? I don't want to give too much away, but I think there's some trailers already out there.
Mm-hmm.
For the Wanderlust?
I play a nudist.
That you play a nudist?
I play a nudist winemaker. That situation...
And novelist.
Aspiring novelist. That situation never comes to pass because there couldn't be anything less arousing than being naked in front of a lot of people. So I never had to think, don't get excited, because it was so...
Maybe the opposite.
Show
him something.
Show him something, right. Make this baby dance. Give him something. Give him a nod.
Pretend it's not cold out.
That's right. It wasn't an issue.
There was a nod in the film, if I may.
There is a nod in the film. Yeah. It's one of my favorite shots.
Yes.
In the film. The biggest part wasn't don't get excited. It was like, make sure you don't pee. Don't drink too much water, because then it's a whole rigmarole to get the prosthetic off.
And prosthetic?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I had a prosthetic shoulder.
Oh, I see.
Because he had a bit of a hunch. Yeah.
I got a lot of money riding on this.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
You're gonna win. You're gonna win.
Okay,
you're gonna win
good.
Some money.
Good.
It wasn't an issue.
No, clearly not.
No.
Another thing we like to do as a way to invite our viewers in and our listeners,
mm-hmm.
Write these into the Twitter or the Facebook chat show page, which I know nothing about, but thanks to Elaine Ewan, it exists. Jamie's scouring through these to find a quality tweet five.
Tweet five forever now.
Tweet five is rapid fire five questions,
yep.
Specifically designed for the guest,
okay.
By the viewer. These are Coke or Pepsi, no correct answer, just your take.
Oh, okay.
But designed for you.
Okay.
This one from at Adrian Selman, because that's a name. Ready?
Easy, yes.
Grand Theft Auto or The Warriors?
The Warriors.
Party Down or Sons of Tucson?
Party Down.
January or February?
February.
Roller or inline skates?
Roller skates.
High or bi?
High. I don't know if I understood the question. High or bi?
Hello or goodbye.
H-I or B-Y-E?
Oh, I was thinking the other high.
And the other bi.
And the other bi. Which is why I was so confused. I'm not kidding. Those were the words, the words, that's how I read, is just, memorized lines. I should see the words, and so I'm like, high and bi. I'm going to go high. And now that I know the actual, how the words are spelled and what words we speak of, I still say hi.
Why would they attribute to H-I and B-Y-E to you? Is there a high or bi connection?
I don't know. I'm trying to figure out. High or bi. I don't know. I can't think of one.
Okay.
But big fan of that Beatles song?
The what? The Beatles song?
Beatles song, hello?
Oh, yeah. Hello or goodbye? Well, hello.
Hello, goodbye.
Hello. I do like highs more. Unless if you don't say hi to someone, that's okay. But if you're like at a party and mm-hmm. you see someone, but you should say goodbye to someone.
I don't remember getting a goodbye from Joe.
Yeah, I know. I call myself in the question here because I didn't follow my rule. Was that it? We just tweet five. Oh, we did five already. I win?
We have another one loaded up already.
Okay, great.
What do you win?
Yeah.
That you guessed them correctly?
Yeah, questions about
me. You got
me.
One of the four wrong, actually.
I did?
Yeah. So we're going to give you a second shot at it. This is from @Merlang. Tweet five.
Tweet five forever now. I just got Keckner'd.
Ready?
Yep.
Nick or Simon?
Come on.
Sophie's choice.
Oh, are you kidding? Oh, my God. You crucial. Oh, jeez. Nick cooked for me. I'll say Nick.
Marvel or DC?
Marvel.
Practical Humor FX or CGI Horror FX?
Practical.
Queens or L.A.?
Queens.
Directing, acting?
Acting.
So you did a little bit of... By the way, those were all correct.
They were.
Your answers were all correct.
Well, I guess I'll never be in a Simon Pegg movie. You know? Yeah.
I love Paul.
Thanks.
And you and Bill Hader.
Yes.
How much fun there? Any laughs at all between the two
None.
Of you?
None. It's a shame. It's the most boring film I've ever shot in my life. And Offset, just quiet. Just total quiet. Crickets. he's amazing. I love Bill. He's just a normal guy that is also so naturally funny and talented that... I found him a bit intimidating sometimes, how effortlessly he was able to slip into any voice. And his knowledge of movies is astounding.
Really?
He's a cinephile. And
well, how else could you do Vinny Vidalci unless...
Phenomenal. Blew me away. And then of comic books, because I did read Mag Magazine, but I never really got into comics unless they were horror comics, and he knew all of them. The comics and books, mm-hmm. and so he kind of introduced me to some The Walking Dead and Why the Last Man and some really great series that are now years old, but I had never heard him. And so he's just we're both comic book and film geeks, and that was something that we geeked out about over each other when we first met on Superbad.
Yeah.
I
that's right. You did meet originally on the Superbad.
Yeah. On the Superbad, there you go. The Banksy, the Superbad. Uh-huh. Why is that so funny, though, when you put the in front? What is that about?
I got called out by one of the fans on it saying, you're really funny because you sound so old when you say the Hulu. I enjoy the show on the Hulu.
Mm-hmm.
And I like the fact that you called it that.
Anyway, Bill, great guy.
Yeah. And the experience working on Paul was fun.
Was incredible. It was my first kind of really... it was first movie like that, which is to say lots of effects and CGI, and the first movie where I spent that much time on set and was able to work with, you know, Shaun of the Dead was a huge movie for me. I loved it because it had both things that I loved in it, horror and comedy. And so suddenly I was able to work with these guys.
That's a dream come true.
It was, for 2.5 months in New Mexico. And so I had to pinch myself. And if I will get schmaltzy because I told you my Heyu story. When I got the job and arrived in New Mexico, and there I was in my little bungalow that they set up and had the car they rented and had the congratulation basket from the Universal Studios, welled up. I was so happy.
Yeah.
Because I felt like I finally done what I've always wanted to do and be in a really big movie that was fun with people that I loved.
And hugely prominent roles for you and Bill.
Yeah. And
I mean, 2.5 months on a shoot these days, even those days, which was only a couple of years ago, is a gigantic job.
Huge.
Those jobs rarely exist, especially for wee character actors. But
yeah.
Even for leads, 2.5 months now, that's not as it once was.
Right.
The norm.
It's tough being a character actor, but I love it.
Although the idea of going in for a couple of weeks, bing, bang,
mm-hmm.
so 2.5 months was probably the longest you'd spend on a film.
It was. I mean, yeah.
Now, are you able to go home during 2.5 months? Not
yeah.
that you don't want to leave New Mexico.
Yeah.
Was it Albuquerque? Where were you?
We were in Santa Fe.
I'll
and
say.
We shot in Albuquerque and in Taos, and a couple other places in Las Vegas, New Mexico as well. But my girlfriend came out. Mm-hmm. I actually didn't go home. I didn't.
2.5 months.
Yeah.
Entrenched.
Yeah.
Looking for a building taller than 2 stories.
That's right.
In the entire state.
Yeah, I loved it though. Like, I like that area, you know. Bateman hates it.
The Southwest?
The Southwest, or yeah, that area, because of the turquoise. He doesn't like all the turquoise.
Jason Bateman has a problem with turquoise?
Yeah, yeah, that's right, I'm outing him. Yeah, that's right, Jason. He doesn't like the turquoise and the silver.
He does not care for Mexico, the jewelry of the Mexican people.
Mexico, maybe. New Mexico, not so much.
Too new for him.
All right.
Yeah, so it was too new. It was too new.
Yeah, he prefers old Mexico.
Yeah, that's right. I loved it, and so I wanted to
stay.
What
about turquoise?
Turquoise, I'm okay with. I'm not crazy about it. Don't hate it.
How much do you own?
My mother owns a lot of turquoise. So, you know,
so it
looks
great on
her.
You grew up around it.
I grew up around, I was comfortable around turquoise and silver. It wasn't as foreign. It might have been foreign to Bateman. Maybe it was like, I don't know. But it was more of a sapphire or a garnet person. I was very much
in
around
Florida,
turquoise.
You had coral.
Oh, my goodness. In Florida, coral.
Turquoise.
An off pink, a aqua. Uh-huh. We had mint green.
I'll say.
A lot of aqua. Strangest names, city names, at Coral Springs and Coconut Creek. I would tell people these names when I went up to New York, and they would laugh at me because they thought I was joking.
Or a bumpkin.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know. Anyway,
Joe the bumpkin.
Joe the pumpkin.
Bumpkin.
Yeah.
Have you met Joe the bumpkin?
Joe the bumpkin from Coconut Creek. Yeah, lots of colors, lots of Miami Vice colors down there.
So you were fine.
So I was familiar with...
Jason Bateman, by the way, is one of those truly unfair gifts from God, like the John Hamm.
I love
him.
You're
not supposed to be that attractive.
I love him.
And able to be that funny.
And able to be...
And a real human in person.
A real human. Yeah. And able to be charmingly professional. Like, just so knowledgeable of... Every aspect of the production.
Well, in his case, he's been on a set since he was 4. So,
true, yeah. But that could also go a bad way.
Right, hate everyone.
Yeah, I mean, it went a good way with Jason, and just...
Very well-mannered, almost Canadian.
Almost Canadian,
yes. In his disposition.
Always, yeah, not mean to anyone.
No. Nope.
Very Canadian.
Yeah.
It was really a treat to be around him, because I hadn't met him until Paul, and was always a fan as well.
And did you find yourself having to pull away from his... gaze?
Yeah,
because it has its own gravitational pull.
Yes, it does. He's his own tractor beam in and of itself that I was kind of pulled. Because I think I asked him about,
Teen Wolf 2?
And it's her move, you know. No, I asked him about like just the workings of publicity, of getting a publicist and all this stuff that now I don't really care about or care for. Because it's all, you just get disillusioned with it once you see how it works. But, you know, like, you've done this, how do you handle, like, publicity? Because I'm thinking of getting published now, this is the big movie, I think he said, you don't really need one. I don't remember what he said, because I was drawn into his tractor beam and his gorgeous brown eyes. He does have a very seductive gaze.
Yes.
Indeed.
You don't know why or how he got inside you.
But he did. Right. And I love, and I'm warm.
And I mean physically. I don't mean metaphorically.
That's right. No, yeah. I was talking to him here. Now he's, where'd he go? Oh, there he is.
He's in me.
We did just make a homosexual joke about Bateman.
Well, I don't know that it was a joke as much as it was a natural
progression
observation
of that particular conversation.
Of his
that
power
happened.
And strength. As a tractor beam human being. Speaking of a great talent with his own tractor beam, I would like to welcome Sam Levine into the proceedings.
What?
Here
as
we go.
Roll
a generous
the
introduction.
Musical
roll that.
Cue for
roll that thing.
Who tweeted?
Oh.
Oh yeah, buddy.
Oh, wonderful. Oh, you're coming.
Celebrities have so much to say.
Who tweeted?
Is the game
here,
we're gonna
way.
Play?
Great. Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, this is an exciting one, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Saturday edition, who tweeted? It's good times. All right, so we went over the rules before, but I'm going to review them with you one more time.
Okay.
So I will read a series of 8 tweets, one at a time.
Okay.
At the end of each tweet, or while I'm reading, as soon as you feel you know who wrote it, you ring in by saying your name.
Right.
I will point to you, and then you have 3 seconds to say either Tyra, Paris, or Bieber.
I thought maybe we should warn the guest also how you will read each tweet with tremendous exaggeration and verve.
Tremendous enthusiasm?
You will.
I will. To be honest, I'm often reading them as they appear written.
In all caps?
All caps,
I was
going to
ask, so if you're yelling, I'm assuming it's all caps.
He's going to yell every time.
Not every time. Not every time. Sometimes they're dark.
What's your italic voice?
You're going to find out. Okay. You're going to find out. Now, here's how the point system goes.
How does the point system work,
You ring and you get it right, you're going to get yourself 5 points.
Okay.
You ring and you get it wrong, you're going to lose 3.
Okay.
There's a penalty for being wrong.
That's right. Okay. And once
lesson
someone is rung in, whether they get it right or wrong, we move on to the next question.
It's a great lesson in life. Can I get you some more water, by the way?
Yes.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I could use a little bit.
There are no second chances.
Okay.
But here's the thing.
I'm fine with the water. I'm listening. I can multitask here.
Sorry. I cannot. God damn it.
Sorry.
So,
I just had to make sure that the guest needed more water and could... Couldn't, in fact, have it.
Can't have it. Watch how I psych you out.
Well, if everything
don't have it, here's your water. Shut up and play our little tweeting game. Okay?
I'd like to personally thank Jason Calcanis for making sure there wasn't a pitcher here or anything else from week to week.
This the infrastructure. Place, if I come in here one more time and everything's changed around, I don't know why.
It is fan-fucking-tastic.
It drives my OCD crazy.
Sammy, why is there a 20 on the table?
Yeah, because if you win, you get this $20
because
bill.
Because money makes things interesting. Another life lesson.
Money makes the mayor go round.
That's right.
That's the prize, sir.
Are you ready to play Who Tweeted?
I have to bring you right back to...
What's happening? Doom
so
out
not
there.
To bring you right back. 2 days as captain of the swim team.
Yeah.
At the apex.
Yeah.
Of your competitiveness.
Or coolness.
Well, I'm going to go with competitiveness because I've seen photos of you in a suit from those days. Mm-hmm. And how the...
Pardon me.
That can't be good for the live feed.
What if there was like a velociraptor out there that just took every...
Again?
And this is the last show, the chat show, because any minute now,
it's gonna burn
live... Shake on the internet.
Shake your head around.
That's it.
Now I'll be disappointed if anything but that happens.
Yeah.
All right. Here we go. Tweet number.
Is it Sam's mic?
Can we check the connection on Joe's mic?
Jesus.
Check the connection.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Stan.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Oh, that's what it is, huh?
You want him to unconnect it and reconnect it?
Very exciting.
Wait, is it still going? Stopped, right?
Yay.
All right.
Thank you, Justin.
NYU Film School.
Okay.
That's what they taught me.
Okay, we're back.
All right.
Tweet number one.
Mm-hmm. The Velociraptor's not going to come?
You're familiar with hashtags?
Yes.
Great. Tweet number one. Oh.
I think it's Sam. What are you moving? What's happening?
There's no way that's me.
Is that the voice in my head? No, now what do we do?
This is dead air. This is 139 episodes. We're not ready.
I have to blame myself on this one, guys.
Okay, they're checking.
Right, looking into it. While they're looking, we're going to play this game.
Let's do it.
I don't care if the audience can hear it, because this isn't for them, it's for you.
That's right.
Tweet number one.
Yep.
In the studio recording a love ballad, hashtag Happy Valentine's Day.
Kevin Bieber.
Incorrect.
Too obvious.
Can I jump in on this?
No, you
don't
have to.
Sir. Got it. Afraid not.
Okay.
You don't have to guess. It's just over.
That was Paris.
Paris?
Yeah.
Paris. Recording.
I wanted to prove to you that these questions are not obvious answers.
Right.
That's right.
Okay. Recording a ballad, you'd think Bieber.
Yeah.
-3.
-3.
That's what you get for
so
that.
So far, thought. I'm up.
You're winning by default.
Come on soon, baby.
The two sweetest words in the English language.
By the way, JL, first two letters, so destiny.
If you only had didn't have the separation between O and T, it would mean more.
It would.
Tweet number
two.
Here
we go.
Okay, go.
Worked out with the new trainer this morning.
Kevin Bieber.
That is correct.
Oh, he's right back at.
I am +2.
It's all right. It's all right. It's all right.
Suck
it.
I know.
Tweet number.
That's my splash.
Three.
All right, Captain.
Mm-hmm.
Tweet number three.
Yep.
stay laser focused and be the CEO of your life.
Joe Tyra.
That is correct. Nicely done. Nicely done.
That was played like a champ.
Tweet number 4. Getting exciting. Chilling at the Playboy Mansion with at DJ.
Joe Bieber.
You can't be right.
I'm sorry, no. It's okay. It's tie game.
Here's good news.
I know he's younger than.
What was the correct answer there?
That was Paris.
Chilling at the Playboy. Playboy Mansion.
Playboy Mansion with DJ Afrojack.
We're tied up.
We are.
Plus 2 apiece.
Oh, yeah.
Is this the last question?
4 more.
Oh, okay.
We're just halfway there.
As much as you'd like it to be over.
Tweet.
And we're done here? No.
Tweet number 5.
Yep.
Getting ready to go to the Grammys.
That's it?
That's all we got.
Getting ready to go to the Grammys. Could be any one of them.
Could be.
Kevin Parris.
Fuck, that's correct. This is bullshit.
It's
a shot in the dark there.
Yeah.
All right.
I went with the non-obvious.
There's still
time.
Well,
I was going to go Joe Tyra. I was going to go non-obvious.
There's still time. Tweet number 6.
Change your name to Joe Tyra. He's got a great ring. And get rid of that L.
You're going to like this one. You're going to like this one.
For good.
Okay.
Just won $30K playing blackjack at Win Las Vegas. Hashtag yes. I love gambling. Smiley face.
Joe Tyra.
No.
Ah, that was Bieber.
Paris, that fucking cunt.
Yes.
The C word has been delivered.
How dare she? Just won 30 grand playing blackjack. I got nothing. That's more than the bulk of your followers will make in a year, you brain dead idiot. Why go boasting that around? Why?
I'm going to go with brain dead idiot.
Holy shit. What happened here?
A bit more of a chasm has developed between my guest and
I. Oh, boy.
He's at -1.
No, wait, what just happened there?
And I'm at +1.
Oh, you ringing got that wrong as well.
Yeah.
All right.
There are 2 questions left.
There are 2 questions remaining.
Oh, so this is possible.
The last one is worth considerably more.
Could be.
Oh, okay.
It's
like double jeopardy.
So still in the middle.
Okay. Could be.
Tweet 7.
Here it is. Very exciting. Getting exciting now.
We still streaming? Any chance?
Could be.
People still watching?
I still DM. I still follow. I still reply. I still love you. Do you have any questions?
Kevin Bieber. I can tell you, based on Sam's reaction, that that's a yes.
Fortunately, that is correct.
He does not want me to
win. Oh, boy.
I do not like it when he wins.
Fortunately for you.
Yeah.
Last question worth 15 points.
Great.
Truth.
Okay. Anyone's game.
Anyone's game, then.
But you have to answer correctly.
To get it.
If I answer correctly or incorrectly, it won't change anything.
I have to get the right answer.
Right. It's on you,
buddy. Boy.
This is 20 bucks. All up to you.
All right. Okay.
Here it is for all the marbles. Put the pen down. I don't need it. There's no marking.
Where did you get that? Barney's? Okay. Here we go.
In 1992.
Joe Barney's.
That is correct. The pen came from Barney's.
How dare you make a mockery of this game?
No. Here we go.
The 8th and final tweet. Here it is.
Yeah. Yep.
Loved speaking with my fellow Harvard Business School students today. They asked some great questions. Keep studying and follow your passion.
Joe Tyra.
That is correct, ladies
there
and gentlemen.
There we go. Oh, I love process of elimination. I love when questions are like that.
That's how we do it. That's how we do it here.
Thank you, Sammy.
My pleasure.
Right
done,
thank
sir.
You, Sammy.
Sam Levine, everybody.
Right in there.
How about that?
How about we did? I did
it. Come from behind, victory.
Underdog. I like underdogs. I live as one.
The game that we just played.
Even though you're not on Twitter, how fascinating and enjoyable was the game? Perhaps now.
That I won?
We'll get you on Twitter.
Yeah, you know, I need to jump on the Twitter. I just got to do it.
Why are you fighting social media?
Because
I'm
not fighting social media.
Why do you reject it?
Okay, I'll tell you. Here again, this is kind of the high and mighty annoying thing.
Mm-hmm. The very serious child.
Yeah.
That became the pretentious actor.
That's right. And now the pretentious anti-social media guy. I have enough friends I don't need the Facebook. I like the friends that I have. I like to be able to actually talk to, get in touch with. That's one.
The fans are waiting for you on Twitter.
I know. And the Twitter, and I love fans. I'm the type of person that would have to write something clever and funny every time I did a Twitter. And I'm terrified of becoming obsessed with writing something funny. Like Michael Ian Black, a pro, is so good at it. Many of my friends are.
He's fantastic, but can I tell you something?
Yeah.
The fans want more than that.
Do they?
They don't want just funny quips. Oh, no, no.
Yeah.
I'd like to know what the hell's going on with you.
Even if I'm having a tuna sandwich that may be on soggy bread?
Actually, you'd be shocked at how many people
really
go, how soggy?
Yeah.
In a reply.
I guess I'll buy that.
I'm serious.
I get bored of myself with...
Here's what you can do.
Yeah.
You jump on there.
Right.
You retweet some other funny people, share those with your followers.
Oh, that's a good idea.
And then you throw up some of your own thoughts as well, your own musings, but no pressure. I think that what holds back a lot of creative people like yourself is the pressure to succeed, when in fact, the fans want this.
Kind of this.
They want to know what's really on your mind, what you're really doing, what you're really thinking. Are you excited about the film opening next Friday?
Sure am.
What preparations? A special food being gathered at the house? Family in town.
Cauliflower.
You flew in the folks for the premiere?
I did,
This is something that they'd like to know on the Twitter.
I guess they would. I guess you're right.
What was the first premiere you flew in the folks for? First of all, you probably flew yourself in because you've only been out here from New York for 2-3 years.
Well, the first movies I was in didn't really have what Hot American Summer? I don't even know if we had a premiere on any large level.
Role Models?
Role Models, yes, we did. The first premiere that I flew my parents in for was Paul, I believe.
Nice.
Yeah, because they had also visited the set as they did with Wanderlust. So it was a nice kind of closure, kind of full circle, see the whole process thing. That was the first premiere that I flew them out. Premieres often I get uncomfortable with because
it's nice to surround yourself with family.
Yeah,
friends.
Yeah, absolutely. It is. It makes things a lot more fun for me.
Yeah,
for sure.
For example, they're here in town now.
Mm-hmm.
We mentioned that the Wanderlust premiere was a couple of nights ago. I know Sam, Jamie, and I had an absolute blast.
Thank you for coming again. Thank you for
She's
coming,
not in the room, but
Eve, not in the room, but you're sharing her feelings. She also enjoyed.
She had a fantastic time.
Herself tremendously.
I'm glad that you have your next 2 months booked.
Yes, thanks to you and the film. We have David Wayne booked on March 4th. Mm-hmm. The show Walter has threatened to come on, although not in the film.
As has the Mib.
And now we have
Carrie Kinney.
Oh,
Carrie Kinney, who's fantastic. Good. The Apatow is threatening in 6 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
The Paul Rudd we've had, although we did not talk to Paul about his love of karaoke with you. But before we get to that, let's stay a little on topic with mm-hmm. the Wanderlust premiere and bringing the folks out. We mentioned the nudity.
Yeah.
For comedic purposes.
Yeah.
I did not know that we would see as much of you in the film as we did. So the first time all of you came on screen, mm-hmm. I couldn't help but glance down the row as I was sitting 5 seats from your parents, glancing down the row. And can I tell you, first of all, you were looking up at the screen, so you may not have seen what I saw, because
mm-hmm.
I was looking at them in profile. Would you like to see what your folks were doing?
I would love to.
As you first appeared in all of
Now, this is the first first introductory scene of my character?
All the way to the coming up to the window
to
when
the window.
Car
okay.
is
yeah, I would yes.
overturned.
Yeah.
This is both of your parents.
Okay.
They shared this expression. Are you ready?
I'm so excited. Yeah, I'm so excited for this. Yeah.
First of all, would you care to venture a guess as to what their expression might have been?
Yes.
Had you warned
them? I think they'd be different. Yeah, of course. Yeah. I think my mother's might have been this. Which is her reaction when her child is either
vulnerable
or in danger. She had that expression when I got my black belt in Taekwondo when I was sparring. Someone took a picture that I saw later. That was this. My dad, I would venture to say he might have just been doing this. I think. Like you but I'm curious.
Like you were maybe sipping tea.
Yeah, like just, you know, he could have been watching, you know, Ghost Protocol with the big Dubai sequence. It was just, he's into the, this is, what a terrific movie. Great poker face.
I'm happy to account, first of all, both wrong on both accounts.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I love yours perhaps better than what I'm about to represent. This is what I saw as I glanced down the aisle as you dangled before us on the giant screen. Both of your parents were doing this. It was sheer joy and genuine laughter.
Oh, that makes me happy.
And they were doing exactly what the rest of the audience was doing. They were in the moment and enjoying it for all of it was without any of the parental pressure or protection that comes from from the DNA of having raised you. They were actually loving it. And I was so
happy
you in that moment.
They're amazing people. They just really do and have always enjoyed the stuff that I did. And, you know, thank God they didn't really know about how the business works. Right. I think they would have been a little bit more hesitant. And encouraged me to do other things. But they always were so supportive that, and I think they genuinely liked watching me perform even as a kid, you know.
Well, it's a big part of it, right? The experience.
Yes.
The parents say, you're not doing this. You know, we've heard so many different versions over the years. So once I got to see them in sheer joy of celebrating just how funny you were being in the movie, and oh man, did that feel good. For me, just being so thrilled for you. Was there a performance years before that maybe they saw and had something to say after the show that...
Never.
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 It was always just...
Yeah, they've always, and I really applaud them for it, they've always been the type of people that kind of let me make my own mistakes, give advice if I asked for it, but supportive and just there... you know, waiting to, you know, help if I needed it.
Or enjoy it when you weren't.
Or enjoy it, yeah, when I wasn't. But never really, they're not judgmental people by nature,
which is odd, because you're so very...
Oh, well, believe me, I still haven't talked to you about this tweeting game that we just played. the fact that they were able to do that, I mean, that's a... I don't know if I can be as... supportive if I have children, if they wanted to do something like this. I mean, truly, and this goes with just all aspects of my life, not just, you know, acting and being in this business, you know, any...
How old were you when you got the black belt in the Taekwondo?
I was 17, and I have not trained since then, another perfect example.
I wasn't going to ask you to give an example.
Thank God. But a perfect example of them being like, yeah, if you want to do that and maybe get hurt, that's okay. We can, you know, do it. They've never been one to throw any of their insecurity or hesitation about.
They would come to your meets when you were captain of the swim team?
They came to a few meets. They actually got me involved in swimming when we moved down to Florida when I was so pissed off I wasn't going to speakeasies anymore at 6 years old.
Couldn't get a good pie.
Yeah. They sent me to swim classes, and then I was on a community swim team. So they wanted to make sure little Joe didn't drown in the canal back in the backyard. So
the canal that you fished from.
I fished from a canal in the backyard. It was truly was like a wonderland, Florida, because there was nature and birds and alligators and snakes, and oh my God, we're just
How
in
close
a movie.
Did an alligator come to your home?
Up on the bank of our backyard bank near our pool that was enclosed, but.
Bigger than you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they had, there was a couple of them. We moved down because the development had just been built, and so the waterways were new and were still bringing in, you know, gators that lived there up until the point that houses were built only a year or so ago. So they constantly had game wardens coming in, like, taking gators out of the canal, and it was incredible to me. I was not afraid at all. I loved snakes and lizards and had a bunch of those, and the fact that there was a gator in my backyard was the best thing ever.
You have one now. It shows clearly that you held on to the infatuation. And
that's right. And so I have one in the tub that I keep.
Petey? Yeah.
Petey. Petey Gator. Petey Gator. And Alan the alligator. And Bob the bad name.
I want to ask you actually about shooting the new movie.
Yes.
Once again on location. This time you were where?
We were in northern Georgia, in the woods of northern Georgia. Clarksville was the name of the town.
All right. What's nice about the shooting on location,
mm-hmm.
I'd love to hear your take on the atmosphere of all the cast and all the crew living basically under the same roof at either one hotel or a couple of hotels. Some of the bigger names might rent themselves a house, but for the most mm-hmm. part, everybody sort of hangs out in these hotels at the hotel bar. And was that the experience at all?
No.
Not even
we,
close.
Close recruited. We actually did have cabins that they rented for us, the cast. That we lived in. Separate ones. Like, Jen and Paul had theirs. I had one that I ended up wanting to share. It was a big house, way bigger than what I needed.
And you shot at a campground? Where were these cabins?
The cabins were like around the lake. It was, I forgot the name of the lake, but there was a lake nearby that they kind of rented some of these vacation cabins.
Lake Steve.
It was Lake Bad Name. And so we would have parties at these cabins afterwards, and hangs, but the vibe was similar to Wet Hot in that we felt like we were at camp. We essentially were, because we were in the woods and we were in cabins.
And the movie itself is set on this commune, so there's already that atmosphere
that vibe
all
is going.
Day long.
Yeah.
Shooting.
That's right. And it was nice just to have, it was nice to be isolated in a way for all of us to hang out as much as we did, because I think it really added to what ended up on the screen. We had some moonshine, which was lovely. I never had actual moonshine before.
Local moonshine. Grown locally.
Yeah. Grown, they had moonshine trees. It was grown locally, and it was weird, organic moonshine trees. I'll tell you something about moonshine. Moonshine is a type of alcohol that I thought before I had it was so strong that you just pass out. Not true. It's strong, but what it does do is make you have conversations with Jordan Peele in the pouring rain as if it was not an issue. And it made you do things that were absolutely, made me do things that were absolutely crazy, but felt normal. Like walk around in the rain with Jordan Peele and talk about horror movies as it's pouring. It gave me some energy moonshine. I thought it was just going to knock me out. It was like Red Bull alcohol or something. And then I guess it's...
Because it's clean.
It's clean. And I guess there's that fine line where one more week of fermentation or whatever they do, then blindness. But up until then, terrifically energetic alcohol.
Wow.
So
I think you sold us.
Yeah. Well, there we go. And so I brought, for the last half of the interview.
That sounds pretty good.
Yeah, it was fun. And so the vibe really was very familial. And
Jennifer and Justin having sex yet at this point?
No. This is, let me bust it out right here.
Please.
There was none of that on the set at all. We all hung out.
Sure.
And obviously that's where they met. But there wasn't anything like that until well after we had been finished shooting. Mm-hmm. Again, we all just loved hanging out with each other so much that it felt like a big orgy.
Sure.
But there was no orgy-ness going on. There's too many clothes for the orgy.
Yeah.
You know? It just doesn't work.
Right.
That really is the truth of it. You know, I did stupid things like drink moonshine a lot. But there was no...
Which crew member offered you the moonshine?
It was a local restauranteur that I don't want to name only because I don't
no
think
reason
it is.
To. But you would dine at a restaurant and he would mention, you know, if you want some of the local flavor,
so
I have some.
Come out,
I can bring it to the cabin if you'd like.
Right in the back
In the parking lot. I mean, with cabin, no, he's not going to part ways with that. The cabin, forget it. It'd be gone in, you know, very soon.
Did it have funny special names, the moonshine?
No. I went for half a second. I was trying to think of a clever thing, and then it was
too long.
But no, it was like peach moonshine and like apricot moonshine.
This week's.
Yeah, this week's moonshine of the week.
Right. I keep meaning to join that club.
Yeah, vanilla moonshine.
Very expensive.
The moon. Yeah, it's like Tobler's Creek wine. It's the moonshine of the month. It comes to
aged
the door.
Aged in transit.
That's right.
Yeah. I
was trying to think of something else about Wanderlust, but...
There seems to be a tremendous amount of improvisation. I heard the word word reshoots being used a lot afterwards, mm-hmm. which is often cause for concern.
Mm-hmm.
But because I didn't know there were any reshoots, and I just saw the movie, having no knowledge whatsoever of the shooting or editing or post-production process, I went up to David Wayne and Ken Marino, who wrote the piece. David, of course, directed as well, and said, it just works on every single level. And then they would go off into, well, we got this and the reshoot and that, and mm-hmm. and it didn't register for me, because it's so hard to have a love story within a silly-ass comedy that isn't preachy or doesn't shove itself in your face. For me, one of the problems with Bridesmaids is the love story. It's just too genuine for this silly-ass movie that's going on around it. That's masterful to me, and one of the hardest things in the world to pull off.
It is, and you know, to their credit, which is to say Kevin and David and Judd's and Paul's, is that they wanted to get to some emotional center of George and Linda, the two characters Paul and Jennifer play, to build off of. And for me, the movie really kind of kicks in dramatically during the truth circle scene, because I feel like that scene is where it really kind of gets real, and it's still funny. It's hard balance, like, and I think they did a great job with it. And then you have third act problems, of course, of tying that up, which I think they also were successful. That's them writing and writing and writing. And
seriously
writing. You know, even, you know, while we were shooting, off, you know, take is done, I go off, and Ken and his wife Erica also was writing, and Justin over the, and David over the, you know, laptops, you know, throwing out jokes. And I think Judd also pushed them on that too. I mean, Judd's the type of producer and filmmaker that wants those options. And I think that's how you finally get to it. You have to keep just writing a shitload and seeing how a lot of it's shit. Well, that just doesn't work.
Sure, you got to throw it out there.
Yeah.
There was a lot of improvising on the set, I assume.
There was. I think David's method was to kind of get what's in the script, get that done,
and then
get any alts that maybe, because they were covering themselves on emotional beats as well with the characters. Just like, well, let's cover it with her character and doing this, and cover, you know. Once that's done, then we get to play, and that's always fun, because I just like to try to crack people. I just try to make people break. It's terrible. It's a completely selfish thing to do.
It is really awful.
But it is. It really is. I try to, like, surprise. I guess I should try to surprise whoever I'm with some things. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not the first guy to do this.
No.
You know, it's not like, oh, really? Oh, that's interesting.
But you all know each other so well and for so long.
And so it's harder
at some
to
point,
do that.
It becomes a personal challenge, and that's exciting.
That's exactly right.
There's a scene, a movie-stopping scene, a showstopper, where Paul's character looks into the mirror and is trying to psych himself up.
Mm-hmm.
That's all I'll say.
My favorite comedy scene in the movie.
What happens in this moment is kind of rare, but essential for me if the movie is a great comedy. And that is that someone got to do something silly and they just let it go. They just let it continue beyond the line that you thought it was going to end. It's actually going to breathe. It's going to go to a few surprising places, and then even further.
Yeah.
It seems like in most comedy films, certainly in comedy television, that there's just no time for this kind of thing. We got to keep the. Mm-hmm. You got to be true to the story. Let's take a break from the story. and just let somebody have a silly ass moment and make me laugh uncontrollably.
Yeah.
God forbid that should happen in a comedy.
Yeah, well, I it is rare, and I think it's important because of that reason, which is, one, it's funny, but also you almost start to care about the character more.
Yeah.
If they get you at like a gut level like that laughing, where whether or not it's succeeding dramatically or story-wise or character development-wise, you buy it because it's genuine, it's real, and they got you. So
it's going through something.
It's going through something. They're seeing an actual evolution, emotional thing. And yeah. And you only get that with riffs that last that long. It's hard to do it with cuts and you know, where you feel manipulated by the reaction cut that they go to. You know, I wish more comedies were like that, more studio comedies were like that.
Right.
But I think they did that in Bridesmaids a number of times. There's certain
comedies. Well, when it was going for the silly, it accomplished it.
Yeah.
Big time.
For sure.
Yeah.
And it's just rare. And I you know, that's Dave. That's a lot of filmmakers. Like, you know, Greg Mottola was like that. And, you know, David Wayne, like, if something's going, they let it go.
Well, in the case of I Love You, Man, for sure.
And Hamburg. And absolutely. And John Hamburg.
Paul got to go further and further.
Slap of the bass.
Yeah. All that stuff was, and, you know, you could see in the outtakes that they were letting him find, beat the joke, try it different.
Well, it's funny you bring that up, because also why that work is, you know, obviously it's Paul, but the reason why I think Paul pulls that off is because Paul, and he'll tell you this, is also the type of person that will go off on a riff, just not in front of the camera, just on a bad joke or riff or pun, for hours. And I'll do it with him. And, you know, and many of his friends would too. Like, you also have to be the type of person that see how long, is this going to go for a while? I do that, you know, with my friend 80 Miles, who's right on Fallon, and it drives my girlfriend crazy, as well as Miles' wife, I think, that where it's like, all right, enough. Ken Marino will go on bits for a long time, and I love that stuff. And so you also have to be the type of comedian or actor that loves to try to crack himself up and doesn't mind, like, it beating the dead horse.
Right.
Because there's some that are like that, that like will suddenly listen to themselves and stop and just be like, okay, all right, sorry, I'm done. I was stupid. Was that good? I don't know. All right, that was okay. No, that's
the beauty of it, I think.
That's not Paul.
Just to not edit.
Yeah.
Just hang it out there.
Yeah. Let him swing in the wind, man. Let him swing in the wind. It's funny.
Speaking of which, your performance is wonderful in the film.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks. Thank you.
And may I just point out, because I always love to be told this ahead of time, make sure you stick around for the end credits of the feature.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
There are some extra goodies.
There's some extra goodies. Really, up until the very end, until the last credit, there's a little goodie at the end of that as well.
Yeah. A bon mot.
Ah, indeed. Mm-hmm. Yes. That was big in Role Models, too.
Yes.
End the point, or we can move on, is the idea of riffing so much. Like, Paul and I was trying to think, we were just trying to think of how a theatrical, let's think of Greek gods and what, terminology, let's just think of terminology and Greek gods, and we'll just throw those out. And, you know, that voice was came from a couple places. One was an actor, a British actor by the name of Brian Blessed, who it was in I, Claudius, but I knew him from the movie Flash Gordon.
I'll say.
And he played Captain Volton. And he plays these hardy, he was a hardy character. And, he had this, there was this, a bunch of Vulcans that they were flying, and he's chasing, Flash Gordon. He's like, impetuous boy. you can't live forever. Dive! and I'm like, oh, that, what a great voice that, what a great, and so it definitely came from there too. And then it was just trying to do an English accent and fit different Greek god terminology into the puns. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Paul and I were just doing that the entire time before the cameras roll. And so that, again, was so long that people were getting bored of it. And I'm like, not funny anymore. I'm like, well, we're just going to keep doing it. The camera's going to go, because we're not stopping now. We're just going to go.
You were full enough to shoot on digital.
Yeah. Yes.
We know. We're not going to roll out.
Nope. No, it was the best advantage. Digital technology is the best advantage for comedians now, who love the ad lib because, oh.
Yeah. They can't shut you down.
No.
You can't say, I got to roll out on two. All right, sir. I warned you beforehand. First of all, congratulations. You got to the 2 hours.
I did.
Yes.
Oh, this is lovely.
Honestly and truly, this is the fun version of the show for me because we just go and have fun and we get the journey and also the funny silly comes out without me saying, do the bit where you say the lady's got pants. What did I have? I just wanted to make sure I didn't miss anything. You had fun at the Sketch Fest.
I had fun at the Sketch Fest.
The Wet Hot American Summer stage reading was incredibly fantastic. You've been at the Sketch Fest now a couple times?
A couple times. Yeah. The State Reunion, Reno, and now.
Is it just every January or is it a couple?
January, and it leaks sometimes into February. Every January.
There's some January leakage.
As it were.
That's disgusting.
I warned you about the Larry King game. This is your camera.
It's time to play the Larry King game on Kevin Pollak's chat show.
They are on it today.
In case you were wondering how serious I was about it being time for your Larry King, we thought we'd play the cue.
The cue it in?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
That's your camera. You don't have to go this second.
Okay.
Shall I reiterate the
boundaries? Yes.
Bad Larry King impression?
Right.
Share something about yourself as Larry that nobody needs to know.
Okay.
Right? This is Larry sharing.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't need to know any of that, Larry.
Right.
And then go to the phone. Funny sounding city is helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's it.
All right, here we go.
Take as much time with it as you want or as little. Totally up to you.
Just crop dusted in the Whole Foods produce session on 3rd. Chichen Itza, Mexico. You're on Run with Juan.
And that's how you play the Larry King game.
That's a game that I'm sure you've played.
You could play sitting
forever.
Around.
Sitting around
with some moonshine.
That's right.
Right?
Ooh, I'm going to do a moonshine, Larry. If I'm ever in Georgia again, get some moonshine, do it, tape it, send it. Because I feel like that's going to be fun. You're going to get some nuggets,
you
some treats.
You and Peel in the rain could have ripped
that's
that
right.
night.
That's right.
Joe, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for
honestly
having me.
Honestly and truly.
Talking to someone whose work I respect very much before I even knew you, so thank you.
We waited for 2 hours for this to come up?
Well, I knew how it was going to go, so I just wanted to get it in there, otherwise it becomes about you. About me.
He's seen the show before.
Wow. Yeah. He watched once or thrice. Thank you, Jerry.
Thank you.
Sit there uncomfortably, if you wouldn't mind, while I wrap things up for the folks at home and around the globe. I want to thank Dr. Chen here in the studio, Sam and Jamie as always. Out there, we've got Adam is back, happily, now president of his fraternity, which we're very excited about.
Lambda, lambda,
his
lambda.
Victory. Lambda, lambda, lambda?
The Tri-Lambs.
Is that a Simpsons reference?
Nope. Revenge of the Nerds.
Ah. I forget how wide range your references are.
I go all the way back to 84 sometimes.
All the way?
All the way.
Sure.
It's not all Simpsons over here. Simpsons and Seinfeld. There's more.
There's plenty more.
There's at least three other things.
At least three other things.
I quote Vacation daily.
If you want me to start quoting Million Dollar Mystery, keep at it.
Let's stop. Elaine Ewing, our social media expert, and working with Josh on the Post for the Hulu, where you can catch the show now, as I mentioned ad nauseum at the top. I want to thank her as well. The Josh Negrin on TriCaster, the Justin Weiss on Sound. These are also producers. And the J-Mac, one of our other fine producers, I mentioned helping with the research, but also out there busting ass with Brendan as well, trying to make sure that the show actually streamed live, where we had some problems pre-show that you don't need to know about. Oops. Who am I leaving out? Because I always forget someone.
Jennifer
Zide on makeup. Thank you for filling in. Our Samantha Ward was elsewhere as we came to you live on Saturday. If you're watching us on the Hulu or the iTunes or you're listening to us from the download, let us know. Write to us. Let us know. Communicate. Reach out. Make it happen. Contact at KevinPollockChatShow.com. Next week is a regular time. Sunday is the Oscars. And I'll be in New York, possibly recording a special live edition, audio only, which I will tell you more about if it actually happens. Mm. And then we return March 4th with the fabulous David Wayne, who co-wrote and, of course, directed the film we've been discussing, Wanderlust.
Wow.
And also, he did the Hot, Wet, Wet, Hot.
He did.
Yeah.
He did. He's directed a few films.
Has he now?
He has. The Ten being one of my favorites.
Let's not forget The Ten. Mm-hmm. Joe was in The Ten, hilarious in The Ten as well.
Yeah.
Didn't get to that.
That's
Wayne right. Days on the interwebs.
Well,
we'll talk more when he's here.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
The Drew Carey is threatened for March 11th.
Yeah.
Check the schedule. Go to the schedule page. We're still filling in them in, the guests to come to the future. That is today's show. I also want to thank Joe's parents for that moment in the theater, because that was one of my favorites of the evening.
I want to thank them for not giving Joe away as a child.
They had that option.
That was an option every day. And they declined it every day, and I'm grateful for that.
It could have been an offering to the alligators to keep them away. Mm-hmm.
Truly.
So many opportunities to get Joe away. Thank you for that. Until next week. Oh, they thought I was buffering. I went to the Bahamas for a moment, apparently.
Wow.
But you can't pause for these people. They are on it today.
They're on it.
They had a meeting before the meeting.
It's Saturday. No one's hungover yet.
Yeah. Well, there's the good news. More shows on Saturday. You know what? Write to us if you'd like to see some more shows on Saturday. Just the crew will write. All right. Until next time, and as always, get out of my face.
Ah, you son of a bitch.